10th, 2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones. This will be another extremely important global broadcast. We've got earthquake out in California. We've got other huge developments geopolitically with the 2016 campaign, ISIS developments, and so much more. But I'm really seeing a trend of society unraveling and degenerating. And on top of that, you've got more and more financial systems that are basically electronic soup kitchens starting to degenerate. So I want to start this broadcast with another very special report that John Bowne's done. Could food stamp riots start triggering within days?
The perfect storm is brewing. Obama's last stand as the Zelenskyite community organizer in chief has a finger on the trigger of mass unrest. When Obama took office in 2008, 28.2 million Americans were receiving welfare benefits. That number has grown to roughly 45 million under the only president in history to not see 1 year of 3% GDP growth.
And there's millions of others that are on state different food assistance programs. So it's 101 million. 101 million get food aid from federal government, outnumber full-time private sector workers. And that's a Department of Agriculture estimate that CNS News reported on. How's that sound? Boy, that sounds like land of the free, home of the brave to me. And all these people are being taught, a guy driving a nice car, somebody that has a nice house, they're rich and they stole it from you.
Earlier this year, it was widely reported that possibly up to a million of the country's poorest welfare recipients would lose their benefits under a welfare policy signed, sealed, and delivered by none other than Bill Clinton. The Fiscal Times reports, those affected are people aged 18 to 49 who aren't disabled or raising minor children. Most of them live a subsistence existence, scraping by with the help of government and charitable organizations and low-income jobs, although college students are also eligible. The landmark 1996 bipartisan welfare reform law, crafted by a Republican Congress and signed by Democratic President Bill Clinton, limited benefits for this group to just 3 months in any 36-month period unless they were employed or in a work training program. Of course, that was pre-Obamaphone Obamacare. Here we are 20 years later and those chickens have come home to roost as the government has reportedly neglected to pay the EBT benefits for 8 days. Michael Snyder of the Economic Blog reports, widespread reports continue to pour in from all over the nation of glitches with the food stamp system. It is 8 days into the month, and large numbers of people still have not received their benefits. And in other instances, it is being reported that EBT cards are simply not working correctly. Michael Snyder continues, on downdetector.com, there are scores of reports of problems with the EBT system from people all over the nation. Could this simply be another example of government incompetence, or is something else at work here? Many things are at work here. The cultural poison George Soros has unleashed on America via Black Lives Matter and MoveOn.org, along with the recently legalized propaganda spewed out by globalist-owned mainstream media taking the side of anti-constitutionalists, fueling violent riots. The Obama administration, the Department of Justice, and the United Nations maneuvering of the Strong Cities Network, a real-time martial law initiative that needs a concrete reason to expand federal control over local police. Not to mention, roughly 11 million illegal immigrants were encouraged by the USDA to take advantage of the United States federal welfare system as the national debt approaches a hallmark of $20 trillion. Obama has overseen the exponential formation of a class of unemployed welfare recipients who expect to be taken care of, or else. It was reported during the Ferguson rioting that two new Black Panther members were planning a bombing of the famous St. Louis Gateway Arch and the murder of the prosecuting attorney in the Michael Brown case, along with the Ferguson police chief. The plan fell apart after one of the accused bomber's girlfriend's EBT card ran out of money. This isn't all happening by accident or by powers beyond Obama's control. Mass food riots are par for the course as a last-ditch effort to install martial law and place the United States under New World Order domination. John Bowne for Infowars.com.
That's right, folks. This isn't the game. We have Tim Kennedy coming in. known as a UFC fighter, but really he's obviously worked in continental government and other areas in some of the most most secretive army units. He won't be getting into any of that, but he'll be talking about, with his expertise, the clear plan to destabilize this country and the world. We just aired in that first little segment that some stations don't carry, a powerful report, food stamp riots within days, John Bound. We'll tweet that out right now at Real Alex Jones and post it to Facebook because it's so important. Peter Schiff has accurately predicted in the last year that gold would start going back up, and he has been proven correct. He will be joining us for 30 minutes at the start of the third hour. We have Rob Dew and our other reporters like Paul Joseph Watson and Josh Owens reporting from Dresden, Germany, where the super secret Bilderberg Group is being exposed right now. They have spent decades trying to keep their, close to 60 years trying to keep their existence secret. That has now failed. And David Knight will be hosting the fourth hour with all the latest news that breaks then as well. And I will be in studio this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. I've been doing kind of a mixed Sunday show where I'm live part of it, but have a lot of taped special reports and then mix it in with David Knight live in studio. But I'll be in studio, Lord willing, this Sunday for the full 2 hours, 4 to 6 p.m. Central as well. Don't forget InfoWars Nightly News, 7 o'clock Central. Let me do this because I don't want to get lost in the minutia. I don't want to miss the forest for the trees, as they say. Let me just state this very calmly up front. This is an unequivocal, incontrovertible, undisputed, absolute, admitted fact for anyone who is even halfway informed. Within science, within intelligentsia, within all known studies, it is absolutely prima facie, on its face, true, not debated. We are dying as a species. You could say that, well, we are growing in numbers, and generally that signifies the species is successful until it reaches carrying capacity and many times collapses. And in a lot of cases historically, with tens of thousands of species that have gone extinct, it triggers an extinction event. There is a planned extinction of humanity planned by the controllers of the planet. That is the world government project's end game. Now, I want that to sink in because I'm not making this up. We were the first people to tell you our government was running Al-Qaeda. The first to tell you they were running the operation to overthrow Libya and Syria to install Wahhabists. The first to tell you what was really in Clinton's emails. The first to tell you hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of huge, super secret things that no one else is able to break or understand. And it's because I've reverse engineered their operation. I am immersed in this 18 hours a day. I have a giant spectrum of top experts around the world, from the highest level of foreign governments to the highest level of the military to the highest level of academia, we have the intel. We know the plan. And anyone that just sits there and makes a joke out of this is tempting fate in a big way. But I'm not talking to the folks that are in arrested development mode and wouldn't know the truth if it ran over them like a Greyhound bus. I'm talking to people that are awake. And I just want to point out that you were correct. You were on target. You took a lot of ridicule. You got attacked because you had a basic instinct and a spirit that was pro-human, pro-justice, and your life force hasn't been basically sucked out of you. That's what it comes down to. And so I don't want to sit here and pat you on the back. I really want to just metaphysically hug you. As we watch the desperate carnage in slow motion go on all around us, and just look you in the eye and say, it's good to know there's still some people that haven't succumbed to the great delusion. And I simply pray that as it gets more intense in the years to come, that I don't succumb. But I know I will succumb unless I count on this true spirit of the universe that created all matter, time, space, thought, light, dimensions. But that energy, that God, the true God, will not come into your life unless you ask it to. It's a free will. It gave you your free will. And when you choose to join God, you become a small expression of God in the world. You become an eye of God. You become God experiencing his creation at the lowest level to the highest level. But to be with God, you have to decide that you want to join with God. There's so much news here. It's all incredibly over the top. It proves everything we've been warning of. But at the end of the day, this is a spiritual war. This is a science fiction dystopia movie you're living in. The people running things are totally given over to the other spirit. And you're not going to sit there and ever change their minds about what they're doing at the highest levels. The top controllers know good and well what they're doing, and they've been promised in their own delusions and in the cosmology, the world system of thought they've created, that this is an ugly creation, that humans are bad, that humans are fallen, and that we need to be overwritten and gotten rid of, and that only by transcending humanity will they become gods. And that's the Illuminati religion, the false Illuminati religion, the counterfeit Illuminati religion that you know is the Illuminati. And you're saying, wait a minute, but God says we're fallen. So what do you mean the elites say we're fallen and have to be gotten rid of? They're the ones that follow the system, the paradigm that has made humanity fallen. They make us fall so that we don't take our birthright and can be interdimensionally incinerated, overwritten, destroyed. And they want us to buy into that and give up our free will and our birthright to populate the stars. Think about that. And they openly say we're ugly and bad and how great the world will be without humans and the great singularity of their God that's about to be born that they will merge with. We are in the hands of lunatics. They're the ones destroying the environment. They're the ones destroying the family. They're the ones creating every form of ugly, twisted abomination you can imagine while telling those of us resisting it that we are the plague. So when we come back, I will plow into the news. But later in this hour, and Tim Kennedy's coming in to talk about this as well, we're going to discuss the metrics that are there. Document that humanity is quickly degenerating at a very fast pace, that it's being engineered, but that our acquiescence and acceptance of it is what is allowing us to be inducted into this, and that the minute we realize that and flip on the basic instincts that God's given us to resist, we will become stronger and actually triumph over it, and it will be the challenge against this dehumanization that will actually bring us to the next level of transcendence. The New World Order thinks humanity is going to fall. That it will be the New World Order allowed to test us. that will force the true human to arise. Satan is broken. Satan has already failed. Since before the foundations of the earth, our birthright will be secured. I'm your host, Alex Jones. Thank you for joining us. I want to start plowing into the news. But coming up a little bit later in the hour, I am going to get into the designed collapse of humanity we're witnessing, that everything else is just window dressing around. And that if we don't have a sense of destiny, a sense of wanting the species to succeed. Because look, the overall message in the media is humans are bad, we're ugly, we're stupid. But oh, we're going to have transgender bathrooms and mommies and daddies are bad and don't say he or she because someone might not be a he or she. It's just total scrambled faux rights. You ever wanted to know what an anti-societal weapon system would look like? You're being hit by it. And they write textbooks admitting they are. Has nothing, people, oh, you're against trannies. It has nothing to do with that. This is a weapon system. This is a joke. This is forced mental illness. And every metric shows mental illness, and I can see it with my own two eyeballs, is exploding. People are acting like babies everywhere. It's because the general public is in a trance state, totally immersed, and their brainwaves in a near-sleep state. That's mainstream news. Children's brains are completely rewired in a bad way. IQs are plunging. Attention spans are less than that of a goldfish. Less than 7 seconds. Most people now I talk to, they're gone. They're not even listening to a word you say. They're bouncing from one thing to the next. And they're not even alive. They respond to stimuli. They don't have original thoughts. They don't put out stimuli. They don't affect the world around them. They are nothing but receivers, not transmitters. And they believe that transmitting nothing and being completely supine is empowering. That's the one false instinct they hold to, that being cynical, being stupid, being foolish, being uninformed is a shield, an armor. But they have words like racist and homophobe and sexist, and they grasp on to class warfare like it's a life preserver in the frozen Atlantic North. They are children caught in a trance by the television, even though they're 30, 40, 50 years old. They were captured early. They were put into Wonderland, into a dream state, into a trance. And now there's just the stimuli of giggling and laughing at Alex Jones, giggling and laughing at Donald Trump, laughing when you hear about the fluoride, even though they tell you it's killing you. See, that's their rule. It's killing you, U.S. government admits, Harvard admits, cancer, brain damage. But still, the sitcoms make jokes, so it feels good to laugh, even though you can't think. And NPR, to the pseudo-intellectual, keeps them in a calm, happy space where you're successful, you've arrived, because you listen to this show and you follow these beliefs and you like Bernie Sanders and Hillary and Bill, and you care and you're progressing because your leaders are in charge and they tell you you're winning the war. The war of inequality. Oh, it's getting so much better, isn't it?
Yes, Hillary's not a warmonger. Everything's fine. We'll be back. Stay with us.
I just clicked on YouTube, though, because a lot of times when other things aren't working, I click on that and it still works. And it was giving me what YouTube wanted me to see. So for like an hour working out, in the background was how great the Queen of England is, and people singing God Save the Queen, and Justin Bieber and how incredibly cool he is, and then just all this mindless garbage. And it was literally just showing me how the West is a dumping ground of the most weaponized brainwashing anyone could ever imagine. And it was showing all these different Hollywood stars and all these different little, you know, two-minute pieces with Justin Bieber and other rock stars or hip-hop stars. And it was just so empty, so clownish, so ridiculous. People on red carpets, people trying to act cool. It was like a caricature of itself. It was like the best comedy, way better than Monty Python. But it was so saddening that I had to turn away. These people singing God Save the Queen for some Transylvanian parasite. With Prince Philip, the eugenicist, sworn to want to kill 80% of the world population, standing next to her with Prince Charles, who lives in Count Dracula's castle. Half the year in Transylvania now. He's like retired to Transylvania. Complete lunatics. Yes, the House of Dragon, folks, rules over us. It's total fruitcakeville. I go to the grocery store, it's just royalty everywhere. Oh, the royalty. You think I was a British subject? And that's just one millionth micron of all the brainwashing, just like Niagara Falls hitting us in the face every day. A total false reality. So I want to tell all the liberals and the trendies and the mainline conservatives and everybody, you all tune in to what you think is the answer, what you think is this spectrum of analysis, and it's all there to make you think you're intellectual and smart because you read the Weekly Standard or National Review, or you watch CNN or MSNBC, or you read a book by Bernie Sanders. I mean, give me a break. The establishment globalist combine with Goldman Sachs at the very top is weaponized, aimed directly at you to make you obsolete and to be a mindless bobble who goes along as a suboid in this technocracy, in their own words. Do you understand Goldman Sachs over 100 years ago was a group of socialists and globalists who pooled their money to create that organization to take over the U.S. stock market, and they did it? Do you know about any of this? Because you need to discover it now. We don't have much time. The admitted world government project is to bring in a technocracy where normal, human, individual, undomesticated life is impossible. Then they will make life itself and reproduction impossible without going through a scientific system. They want a monopoly on all reproduction, on all creatures on the planet. They want to be G-O-D, capital letters, exclamation point. Now, I'm going to get into the news here. But I want to talk to liberals and trendies and everybody else that's cynical and thinks they're in control of the situation and makes a joke out of everything. You have been subliminally and culturally programmed. You've been given hypnotic suggestions. You have been absolutely prepared and programmed to have a response when you're threatened, to make a joke out of it and submit to it, and to only fight on petty issues with fellow humans at a low level. That's how you've been trained. That's how you've been captured. And the boa constrictor is now wrapped around your life, your destiny, the entire genetic line of badasses before you that brought you to this point. And you are desecrating it. You are mutilating it. You are disrespecting it. You are, gotta use it if it fits, pissing all over it. Now, they just put live feeds of the police pepper spraying at Bilderberg in Dresden, where reporters and people are now showing up, daring to just see the world shadow government. And cops in RoboCop future uniforms are just engaging in all forms of evil. I guess that's up on InfoWars.com. We'll get the reporters on about it. But quite frankly, that's just a microcosm of everything I'm talking about here. You must admit to yourselves, I'm talking to our general audience, but to people that have been put into a spell. Do you remember if you were a little girl when you were 4 years old with Barbie and getting Barbie high heel pink shoes and a Barbie dress and dressing up and imagining you were a princess over a kingdom and being on a power trip and just feeling good about it? Now, do you remember being older, maybe 5, 6, 7, and dressing up, and then it felt stupid and you realized that it was make-believe? Make-believe's good in children to imagine big things in their future and to war game and model dreams. But when the dreams are given to you artificially by Disney and you're put in a position to believe you really could be a princess, you then grow up to worship the real princess, the demonic crone of Saxe-Coburg-Gotha, Elizabeth of Saxe-Coburg-Gotha. You see how that works? They give you the false dreams, the false memories as a child, like you're a replicant in Blade Runner. And you become a replicant. You are a replicant, basically. You came from a father and a mother, but they short-circuited the genetic line, the instincts, the rituals, the rites of passage that would trigger your normal ascension to a man or a woman, to a powerful entity. And this flesh suit we wear, this earth suit, it's the same thing. You're part of the Democratic Party. You're part of the Republican Party. You're part of the church. You're part of this. It's all there to totally control you and to make you delusionally, as a boy. I remember being 3 years old, 3.5 years old, jumping off my porch with a towel tucked in to my shirt saying that we were Batman and Robin. And I remember being about 3.5, 4 years old and saying to my neighborhood friend, you know, we're not really Batman and Robin. And I remember I just didn't want to play Batman and Robin after I was about 3.5, 4 years old. Everybody else was still playing it when they were 10 or 11. When I was 12, and I'm not bragging, this is a normal behavior, I was going after women who were 16, 17 years old. They're like, what are you doing, kid, at the pool? Coming up to, you know, a 17-year-old, I just, you're very beautiful. Didn't even know what I was doing. I just, hey, you're beautiful. I was a man, or trying to be one. And that's the difference. I was following my genetic code. I was being a human. I'm nothing special, folks. I'm just a man that can read textbooks written by the White House Science Czar and the Club of Rome and Prince Philip's books and all of it, how they're going to dumb us down, get control of us, poison us slowly, and then wipe us out. First going to make us all sterile, going to have cultural systems so we don't have kids. And I'm sitting here watching them do all of this and destroy us, and I know I'm right. This isn't my opinion. I wasn't playing Batman and Robin when I was 7 or 8 or 9 years old. I was reading the entire World War II encyclopedia by Time Life Books. I was reading the entire World War I encyclopedia. I was reading the entire engineering encyclopedia. It had no idea no one else was doing that. And now I know why all these years later. Because it was my genetics and my spirit was a weapon system against these people, just like you are, and was grabbing the data, trying to figure it out, seeing what adults were saying, trying to decipher the system, trying to find out what was behind it the whole time. Survival, survival, survival. My instincts were, you are under attack. You are under attack. Don't drink that tap water. Ask your parents for water filters. Oh, the tap water's good. Drink it. Drink the water. Feel sick. Feel weak. But I was aware of it. My instinct was overdriving it, growing new neural pathways around the attack. When you're aware of the attack, it flips all the switches on. Don't be a victim that I'm under attack and give up. Say, I'm going to fight. Tell your brain you're going to fight. You're never going to give up. Have the will. Don't let them kill your spirit, your soul, your guts, who you are. I'm going to go to the news. But just look at these headlines. Look at DrudgeReport.com. Just look at it. Mexico buckles under migrant surge to USA. They say they're at their limit. They have a deal with Obama for 5 years to allow the immigrants out of the Middle East, China, but mainly Central and South America that come through. They let them through if they get at train stations and hold on to the trains. The cops make sure they have food and a backpack. This is unspoken, but it's admitted. And then they're allowed to travel through Mexico. But if they get off the train, they are beaten up, 6 months to a year hard labor, tortured, you name it. That's in the London Guardian. But Mexico can't control it anymore because the surge is so massive. Mexico's now going, stop, we got to cut the deal. Exclusive, Border Patrol agent, brutally attacked in Arizona, alien shot dead. But look at this one. Mexico buckles under migrant surge to USA at the limit. Border Patrol agent brutally attacked in Arizona. Hillary humiliation. Bill bragged about sleeping with 2,000 women. Thanks a billion. Drudge dominates in May over a billion visitors. We now have the White House spokesperson saying it's criminal. The Department of Justice now saying it is a criminal probe into Hillary. That is huge. The Germans threaten England, don't leave the euro or we'll cut you off financially. Ah, England being bossed around by the Germans yet again. When it's the globalists that already run England that are planning to leave the EU as part of a larger collapse. Oh, baby burst. 2015 had lowest fertility rate, down 600,000 births. Economy blame. That's right, make you so poor you can't have kids. Summer market panic. Bond yields all-time low. Similar headlines up on Infowars.com. And guys, come in and pop on the microphone. Fill me in. That was our feed of police spraying stuff in people's faces. I saw you, if TV viewers saw it. I'm just in here with all these TVs around me seeing what the crew's saying. We've got the crew coming on in 15 minutes. We'll find out what's going on over there. But think about a government. It's the same thing in Europe where they always go, Ellis Island, the Statue of Liberty. You know, give us your huddles, you're tired, whatever. That's in a poem. They'd leave you at Ellis Island for 3 months to make sure you didn't have Black Plague, this bubonic plague, TB, all these other diseases so they could delouse you, make sure you didn't have flesh-eating bacteria that are carried on lice. No, now it's in the news. They just say, no, we bring in tens of thousands of people every day. Hundreds of them have TB, some of it immune to antibiotics, and it kills you. And we're going to put these people in the schools with your children. And we're going to bring them here sick and pay for it, too. Not because they care, folks, but because they are breaking our will and training us to accept anything and everything. Look at this. U.S. tuberculosis cases rise as foreign-born patients triple the 1986 caseload percentage. Two-thirds of contagious tuberculosis carriers in the United States during 2015 were born overseas, up from one-fifth. That's who's bringing it in. And it's okay, though. You got to put your kid next to him, let him cough on him, or you're a racist. Border ranchers with few options now have police radios just as the border collapses. Oh, but Scarborough a few days ago, they were shocked that Hispanics on the border want a wall. What do you think? They want their kids killed? There's 100,000 dead, 100,000+ missing. Most of it's on the border. I mean, you like your kids getting raped and killed? You like your house getting burned down? Are people threatening to kill you if you don't let them keep drugs at your house? You think they like that? Let's go ahead and play the clip. And this is Esquire. Go ahead. They're talking about Esquire. You guys got audio on that? Or I'm going to blurb with the computer. Let's shut that down real quick because I'm not getting audio in here. As soon as the computer's back up, we'll have that clip for you. But continuing here, ladies and gentlemen, tempers flare at school board meeting over protections for transgendered students. How do you distract the public? We're going to put men in your bathrooms. We're going to put in other bathrooms. We're going to make men and women go to the same bathroom in Alamo Drafthouse, they're announcing. And women will squat over urinals that men use. I mean, that's being announced right now as something they're looking at doing. It's just a total distraction. Oh, TB is coming in, black plague, wet leprosy, all this stuff's going on. But don't worry, we've got tranny bathrooms. That's just a total distraction. College dorms, a new front in U.S. battle over transgendered rights. Yeah, we don't worry about the admitted illegal NSA spying or open borders or our government bringing in jihadi cells or, you know, all the rest of our drug-resistant bacteria-eating people by the hundreds of thousands a year. None of that's an issue. It's... Well, welcome to college. There won't be any jobs for you in the future. We're going to teach you how to be social justice warriors. Now, let's freak out over the inequality of men and women wanting to use each other's bathrooms. Let's not just put in individual bathrooms and go to that model. and say, here, we have this for whatever you are. No, let's just, we're all going in the same bathroom. We're making boys and girls in elementary school and middle school go in the same showers together. We're going to put cameras in there to make sure you're safe, watching you in the bathroom. See, it's all 1984, but to make sure you're safe because we care about you. No, it's all weaponized. Continuing, this is the death of our culture. Again, we've got tranny bathrooms, but we don't have children. People go, good, we're overpopulated. If you don't have 2.1 children on average in a culture, then there won't be anyone to take care of the old, and there won't be a social security system. That's an admitted fact worldwide. But don't worry, we can euthanize you. So that's just some of the news there. This is the manifest brainwashing that's going on. Before I go any further and come back and actually play that clip for you and find out what's going on with our reporters over there in Deutschland, living defense, harmful organism cleansing. We produced a first run of this in December. It sold out in 2 days. We produced three times as much this time. And I thought, well, that'll at least give us a couple weeks of it. I guess it's not. It looks like it's going to sell out by next week, I guess because we're discounting it. By 25% out of the gates? It's $34.95. It's 120 big capsules, and it's got 20-something known herbs and compounds that, in a healthy, clean, not rough way, but very strong way, takes out the garbage. And there's all sorts from bacteria right up to, you know, all the hard little worms and things. Living Defense is just amazing. It's got close to 5 stars on third-party sites. Go to InfoWarsLife.com. Go there. See the reviews for yourself. But listen, it's a bunch of well-known herbs and things. They're good for your body regardless. Get yourself the Living Defense. You know, a child would take one pill a day, but consult your pediatrician. That's what I do during a 6-week detox cleanse. An adult of medium size, 2. Some of these really big, 3. And you do it over 6 weeks. Unbelievable. I mean, you'll start seeing results. I certainly did right away. Living Defense, now available for a limited time. You miscalculated again at InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. 888-253-3139. Living Defense, get yours now. If it sold out last time, you get a chance to try it, and it supports the broadcast. All right. For some reason, that clip from The Morning Joe won't play, so we're re-importing it. It's corrupted in more ways than one, I guess. But I want to play that clip where they're just, I can't believe people want a wall. Oh, yeah, you're next to a failed state with hundreds of thousands dead, 100,000 dead, 100,000 missing, total bedlam, dead bodies everywhere, mass graves everywhere, heads getting chopped off everywhere. I would talk about, you know, 10 heads getting delivered to the police department a few years ago in Arizona, and they would actually have national media say I was a liar. No heads got delivered, even when the heads were dumped off. I mean, that's the stuff they do, knowing that their audience is in a zombie mode. Just tell them there is no drone program. Hillary, I don't have any secret emails. I don't have a secret server. Oh, I do. I forgot about that. None of it's secret. Oh, here's her email ordering them, you know, to cut the secret part off the top. It's just insulting everyone's intelligence. And yes, we fund ourselves by saying get ready and get prepared. But it's what I really believe in. I've actually gone as far as getting generators and storable food and stuff here at the office, not just at my home. Because it's gone from being a possibility to a probability to almost certainty. And I'm not happy about that. I've got stacks of news, mainstream with the elites getting armored redoubts, getting cash and gold, panicking, running around like chickens with their heads cut off. I mean, I don't know what to do, okay? But the public's going into zombie mode. They've weaponized the media where the attention span of the average person is gone. Organizational skills are gone. Those that still are conscious are seen as the enemy. I mean, you're going to see a societal collapse very soon. I'm telling you, folks, it's clear. A mental illness is exploding. We've got these weird criminals that everyone's worshiping, the Clintons, the media behind them. Everybody should get water filtration at InfoWarsStore.com, 10% off promo code WATER, the Alexa Pure Pro, the Pro Pure, they're all excellent as well, all of it. I mean, just get geared up and fund the operation right into the future. And we hope to slow this down or turn it around and stop it. If we're able to do that with your help, thank God. But I tell you, it's moving into a defense mode at this point. And finally, solutionsfromscience.com is another great place to get prepared. Solutionsfromscience.com. Solutionsfromscience.com, you find a wide variety of preparedness products that were created to help keep you safe when disaster strikes, from solar power generators to survival gear, fertilizers. They're all available right now. The Solutions from Science website. And Solutions from Science regularly bought a surplus of solar panel generators and is offering a discount to listeners who visit their website, solutionsfromscience.com, or 877-327-0365, solutionsfromscience.com. Great system. It's just overwhelming at this point. Again, the government is letting people in by the tens of thousands every few months. That's a conservative number, with TB that cannot be treated. And Scarborough thinks it's bizarre that anyone wants a wall. Here it is.
Pretty shocking stuff. So you send a liberal journalist down there. He comes back saying, Trump is right.
That's right. So we said, you got to go down there with no preconceived notions, right? Just an empty notebook. Go to my former home state or my... You know, and walk the border, drive the border 800 miles and talk to whoever you see and let them tell us what they think about what's really going on and whether we need a wall, in fact. Instead of hearing it from the debate stage, let's hear it from the people who are
doing
it.
And the people say, build the wall.
They said, build the wall. They said two things, whether it was Hispanic, Anglo, Democrat, Republican, uncommitted, clueless, whatever. They said, we want a wall, and yet we want it to be married with some compassion toward the people that we're trying to.
Here's another surprising thing from the article is that he said that Hispanics were less sympathetic towards illegal immigrants than whites.
So I think that there's a lot of interesting things
friction,
there.
Probably.
But one thing I think is that most of those Hispanics are first generation, and they see it as unfair that they came over here the legal way.
No, that's not what it is. Hit pause. It's not about what color the people's skin. It's that they're not under the white guilt. They know Mexico has one of the strongest borders in the world. They know that it's a lot of criminals and diseases are coming across. They're not suicidal, okay? That's why. We'll be back. Stay with us. I'm Alex Jones. We've got our reporters from Germany. Big developments there. That's coming up. Huge economic news. The earthquake news. It's all coming up. But right now, I'm going to let this report take us to break because we've got the euro and the German government threatening the British and the UK. You better stay in the EU, even though you didn't vote to be part of it, or we're going to destroy you.
Kit Daniels, Infowars.com. Did you know the Bilderberg Group was directly responsible for the 1973 oil crisis that occurred here in America? Most people think it was OPEC that orchestrated the entire thing, but that wasn't quite the case. It was, in fact, the Bilderberg Group's idea. In May of 1973, about 5 months before the oil crisis occurred, the Bilderberg Group met in secret, and the meeting included several CEOs of oil companies such as Exxon and British Petroleum, as well as President Nixon's national security advisor, Henry Kissinger. They predicted that soon there'd be about a 400% increase in the price of oil. And then, you know, on October 6, 1973, after the meeting, the Yom Kippur War occurred, which directly led to the increase in oil prices. But how did the Bilderberg Group know this? They planned it. But why? As economist F. William Ingdahl noted in his book, A Century of War, one enormous consequence of the ensuring 400% rise in OPEC oil prices was that investments of hundreds of millions of dollars by British Petroleum, Royal Dutch Shell, both of whom were present at the 1973 Bilderberg meeting, and other Anglo-American petroleum concerns in the risky North Sea could produce oil at a profit. He continued, the profitability of these new North Sea oil fields was not at all secure until after the OPEC price rises. So the Bilderberg Group came up with the idea of an oil crisis to ensure profitability for the oil companies connected to Bilderberg. And the former oil minister for Saudi Arabia, Sheikh Yamadi, confirmed this. In 2001, Yamadi said, I am 100% sure that the Americans were behind the increase in the price of oil. The oil companies were in real trouble at the time. They had borrowed a lot of money and they needed a high oil price to save them. Yamadi also said that when he visited Iran in 1974 on official oil business, he was told that it was in fact Henry Kissinger who wanted to raise the oil prices, and that Kissinger wanted a war in the Middle East in order to justify the said price increase. And a few weeks before the Yom Kippur War occurred, Kissinger, who was now the Secretary of State under Nixon, he issued a statement saying that if there was a war that was going to break out in the Middle East, that U.S. military intervention was completely out of the question. Basically, Kissinger used secret diplomatic channels to ensure that not only would the war happen as badly as possible, but that OPEC would use the war to justify a price increase. Kissinger downplayed the war, for example, to President Nixon and took control of the situation himself. In fact, the National Security Agency found out about the war 2 days before it happened, but they were told by the White House, under advisement from Kissinger, to sit on the information. And also, Kissinger told the Israelis to stand down and let the war happen. And the rest, you know, is history. The war occurred. The U.S. gave arms to Israel to fight in the war. And then OPEC, in response, embargoed the U.S., thereby increasing oil prices. Now, I added some links in the video description below that go more into detail about the Bilderberg Group's involvement with the 1973 oil crisis. But at the very least, remember this. The oil crisis shows us exactly why we must constantly watch the Bilderberg Group, and also begs the question, what are they up to now? Once again, this is Kit Daniels with InfoWars.com, and keep checking back on InfoWars.com for continued coverage of the Bilderberg meeting. And also, if you haven't already, subscribe to our new YouTube channel, Resistance News, and also to the InfoWars Underground Insider Newsletter.
All right, that's Kit Daniels, one of our great reporters. We're now well into hour number two on this Friday edition. I am your host, Alex Jones. Thank you so much for joining us. Coming up at the bottom of the next hour, UFC fighter, but really the reason he's on is Green Beret, Special Forces soldier Tim Kennedy is going to be in studio with us for 30 minutes talking about societal collapse, because it's already happening all over the world. Culturally, it's happening here. Economically, it's happening, and it's being organized. And mass mental illness is increasing. They've created an artificial system where people don't ever have to actually do anything while they're being made dependent. That's a perfect storm of control. And we've got EBT cards not working around the country and people melting down. Why are the globalists pushing us towards societal disintegration? We're going to be talking about that coming up in the next hour. In fact, will you guys pull me all those articles from yesterday? Thank you. Now, obviously, there's some big developments here with open borders. Last hour, I played a clip from the Morning Joe where they sent their reporter down to the border for over a month, and he found that the vast majority of people want a border wall, they agree with Donald Trump, and the majority of them are Hispanics. And Hispanics wanted the wall more than Anglos. And they said they didn't really know why, or maybe it was because they were first generation and, you know, had paid their dues. No, I know the folks on the border. They're, most of them are ranchers, and they actually work, and they're producers. And they are 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th generation in Texas and New Mexico and Arizona. Really cool people. And they're mainly Hispanic, and they are almost universally upset about what's happening because they get robbed. They get killed. People walk right in their house. They sever people's heads. They kill their cattle. It is just a collapse. Most women, what is it, 80-something percent of women being brought in get raped by the coyotes. I don't mean the wolves. I don't mean the diminutive wolf. I don't mean the smaller canine. I mean the smugglers. That's on record. But don't worry. The Hollywood White House-funded director, Robert Rodriguez, puts movies out where the cowboy white guys are shooting pregnant Hispanic women. That's not going on. So this, again, is the triumph of the hoax over reality, but it's coming out. At the limit, Mexico buckles under migrant surge to U.S. This is, again, out of Reuters. Oh, Mexico says stop taking people. It's so many are coming into our country to get to you. Some of them aren't leaving. We can't handle it. We need money to then speed it up. Mexico is struggling to stem the flow of Central American migrants. Oh, they're migrants. Traveling to the United States ahead of this. It's all UN language. Ahead of the U.S. presidential election, causing major concern in Washington, which is weighing sending more agents to help. And then the agents get there and load them on contractor trucks and bring them in, contractor vans, to legalize them. In 2014, Mexico moved to strengthen its southern border when a surge in child migrants from Central America sparked a political crisis in the United States. They just call it a child wave. That's a total red herring. Last year, Mexico detained over 190,000 migrants, more than double the number in 2012. And now they say it's just collapsing, and what are they going to do? And they need money. Yes, of course. Meanwhile, remember, Illinois tried to pass a law last year, narrowly was defeated. No. The legislature passed it, but then it was getting held up by the governor last time I checked. Hey, Can we look on the status of Illinois trying to pass a law? Just type in Illinois trying to pass law. I think it did pass. I'm going from memory. Check it. Illinois passing law to let illegals vote. I mean, imagine if Mexico said we're passing law to let illegals vote. That's just crazy. But only in America. Well, now San Francisco hopes Trump fear will lead to voting rights for illegal immigrants in the city. Fox News, locally. The San Francisco Board of Supervisors is hoping that residents of the city who fear Donald Trump's rhetoric and policy proposals will flock to the polls this November and support giving voting rights to illegal immigrants. Amazing. And again, TB pouring in and other diseases that are untreatable in many cases, drug-resistant strains, it's all okay. This is a government literally trying to enslave and kill everyone. This is a government wanting things to completely and totally break down. Meanwhile, Roger Stone has put us in contact with the main group that he certifies as the best group out there that is setting up the Stop the Steal rallies that are now just a First Amendment Trump support and to try to keep the communist and socialist and the White House run George Soros people from completely, trashing Cleveland. And now the police have apologized to us off the record, and I've talked directly to Stone, has talked to him, but they said, we've been ordered to not give you permits, period, or let you meet 10 miles away in a warehouse district where no one can see you, or where the communists can come, I guess, and beat you up. Kit Daniels has this report up on Infowars.com. Cleveland to ban Trump supporters outside RNC. So free speech zones to put Trump supporters on the other side of the planet. Everything else has been rigged. Wouldn't they do this? And I'm telling you right now, I'm going as a citizen out there. The communists and socialists are going to be running around doing whatever they want. And I'm going down there, and I'm going to walk around, and I'm going to talk about the First Amendment. I don't care what the Democrats that run Cleveland, Ohio, have to say. And everybody needs to be there. They know libertarians and patriots and conservatives and constitutionalists. You know, if the government says don't demonstrate or we're not giving you a permit, tend to go, okay, because we don't want to be associated with the communists and, all those folks that run around doing stuff. You're going to let them take over if you do that. It's now time to say, we're going to exercise this, period. We have the police arresting and detaining and doing all sorts of people to reporters in Germany trying to cover Bilderberg, the folks that have opened the borders, the folks that are threatening the UK not to try to leave the EU. They never voted to enter, just like we never voted to enter the Trans-Pacific Partnership that welds the Asian Union, the European Union, and the North American Union together. The city of Cleveland is attempting to suppress pro-Trump rallies during the Republican National Committee convention, a move even the liberal ACLU has called unconstitutional. Democratic city officials are giving pro-Trump groups on 24 hours to complete applications for free speech permits, which they won't give us, which severely restrict the First Amendment rights of applicants. They just say, do this, or that's the way it is. There's only 18 hours of permit time under these regulations. Parade time over the 3 or 4 days of the convention, ACLU General Counsel Susan Becker said, we just found out about that recently. So we are hoping we can really negotiate these points, but it's really up to the city to come back with more reasonable time, places, and manner of regulations. And it goes through how it's really far away in the free speech zones that have all been adjudicated to be unconstitutional. Then we've got House passes Puerto Rico rescue. Ah, the collapse accelerates. The EBT cards suddenly aren't working in many areas. Beta testing. We're going to get to all of that coming up. The 5.2 magnitude desert earthquake shakes Southern California. Is that a tremor for the big 8.5? Seismologists say is 2 years overdue. And if it hits in a populated area, you'll think it's the intro to Thundar the Barbarian. I guess you haven't seen that in the 1970s, you wouldn't know what I'm talking about. But let's just say something out of a disaster movie. So we're looking at all of that. We're also going to be looking at what's happening with the stock market. Stocks drop as government bond yields hit fresh lows. And I've got stacks of articles where the elite are buying gold and hoarding cash and getting armored redoubts. I know we've talked about it forever, but now it's in the mainstream news. But now we go to Dresden, Germany, the site of the most prestigious world government body, which for 60 years they kept secret. Now, thanks to DrudgeReport.com and our reporters and Infowars.com and others, they are forced to report on the goings-on there. And days after we broke it, CNBC, everybody else reported exactly what we said. Trump stopping Trump, stopping the British exit out of the unelected euro, world taxes, carbon taxes, internet IDs. It's all on the table. A giant power grab by an unelected group of crooks meeting with our ministers on their knees, literally, and I'm told in some cases, bathhouse figuratively. Paul Joseph Watson, what has developed since we talked to you 24 hours ago?
Well, of course, the big development, Alex, which Rob will get into in more detail because he was there on the scene, was the big confrontation we had last night with the governor of Saxony, Stanislav Tillich. Now, of course, this is huge because every single time Bilderberg happens, the media claims it's just a talking shop, that no decisions are made, it's no big deal. But we've got this guy on tape, and this is massive, brazenly admitting that he comes here to attract investment into Dresden. In other words, lobbying. This is a huge lobbying scandal, and he's been caught on tape brazenly admitting it. Meeting with politicians, again, as Skelton said yesterday, this is a politician-rich conference. He's meeting with them. He's attracting investment to Dresden. He also admitted that he's basically sitting at the kids' table. So he might get to speak to the big wigs, to the senior Bilderberg elitists at some point, but for the time being, probably tomorrow when he will visit, he will sit, you know, 100 feet away from them and barely get the chance to even talk to them.
And let's be clear, they always do this. They always have about three or four, like Fareed Zakaria or the lady from the Washington Post. They always have a few of these little minions to act like the press is there, but they have to sign an agreement, which is admitted, not to speak about it. And then they'll usually have the mayor or the local billionaire, whether it's New York, whether it's London, wherever, or Virginia, they'll have a local who literally has to sit at a little kid's table and maybe summoned into the real king's court. So this is a modern Versailles, is what Bilderberg really is. Go ahead.
Exactly. And he's gone on the record. He's talked about it because he's not aware of what this is all about. Again, he's committed the cardinal sin, which is to talk about Bilderberg. The first rule of Bilderberg, like Fight Club, is don't talk about Bilderberg. He's broken that rule before he's even attended.
But he's proud of himself because he's saying, hey, I'm here to just get money locally. Sounds like he might be a patriot.
Could be, or he could just be completely unaware of what Bilderberg is all about and why they've enforced this Chatham House rule where they can't go on record about it. But that is an absolutely huge report, and it's up on Infowars.com right now. The other development is today we went about half a mile away from the site of the hotel and found, thanks to a local tip, the water cannons that they're preparing for a big protest
tomorrow. How loving! So Bilderberg prepares water cannons to repulse the knaves.
The article's already up. We need them to add the video to it because that's just gone up as well. So there were two protesters here yesterday, basically, who held cardboard signs. They were harassed by police. They were forced to put the signs away. Later on, we heard that they were reportedly arrested for possessing a tent and, wait for it, a loaf of bread, because a loaf of bread was treated as a dangerous weapon here in Dresden. We were actually told that. That's not confirmed, but that's what we were told that they were arrested for. So for two people with a couple of cardboard signs and a loaf of bread, they've got water cannons ready. Now, that's not to say that there won't be trouble, because also we've got left and right protesters coming together, potentially clashing tomorrow here.
Yeah, let's just say it. The Soros rats are always being activated to come in and stir up trouble. They don't even know why. So the police have a cover when they're ordered to go in against everybody. And again, we're not blaming the police, but that's how the globalists do it. They ship in the anarchists, they stir it up, then the police are ordered to stand down during the first rollout. Then in the second phase of the rollout, they then are told to attack everybody. Go ahead.
No, that's what we've been told, that what usually happens is that they have these left versus right protesters. They start off peaceful, but then an agent provocateur, somebody from the left, because in one case they later identified him, you know, starts throwing bottles at the police, giving the police to go in with the excuse of being heavy-handed. So that's what we've got to be wary of tomorrow. Again, it's Saturday, people are off work, so there's likely to be more protesters here, and it could be a clash between left and right. So that could be the spark that sets off some kind of a police action involving the use of those water cannons and a militarized scoop tank, which is also pictured in the article.
Oh, my gosh. Well, there's the headline, water cannons, scoop tanks. That scoop tank is directly out of Soylent Green. Holy Toledo.
Yeah, and they're parked up there. There was a security guard guarding those three vehicles We went up there, tried to talk to him. He didn't want to talk. After about 3 minutes, we were kicked out by another security guard who came up, and it's all on tape. So, you know, they're getting ready for something big, and it could happen tomorrow.
Well, I mean, this is classic. We saw in Switzerland, the police were really mean the first few days, but then realized what was happening, and they were more pro-free speech, and it was literally villagers marching with torches up to the gates of the situation right out of Frankenstein. But in Germany, you know, the police, I guess, are trying to keep the people from realizing this global government Frankenstein that's menacing everyone and destroying our freedom and destroying our future, that actual Dr. Frankenstein is meeting inside that hotel right now. And God forbid the people ever learn who made the monster, because then they might not just oppose the monster, they might actually oppose who created it.
Well, that's right. And we've got another leak. We talked about the economic collapse, which is, you know, we had that article up this morning, talked about that yesterday. Also, German Federal Finance Minister Wolfgang Schäuble is in attendance at Bilderberg, which is interesting.
He's the one threatening the EU. Yeah. That's the top of Drudge. Let's show Der Spiegel. Drudge has a copy of it. Threatening the UK that will shut all your markets down and won't let you trade with us. I mean, this is economic terrorism. The Bilderberg Group threatens economic terrorism on the UK to stay in the euro. This, I mean, the UK couldn't be conquered by Hitler, but it can be now by Merkel. Go ahead.
It's economic terrorism. He's threatening an economic embargo, saying that there will be no trade deal between the UK and the EU if the UK votes to leave, which is complete nonsense, because the UK would be the EU's biggest export market. We buy their products. They need us. The EU is a corrupt, failing institution that would be in desperate need of the United Kingdom.
The parasite is unelected and is telling you, there's like tapeworms telling you that they're not going to feed you anymore if you kick them out.
Exactly. But another thing, and this is what's coming out, this is another leak. He's also the one calling for more Muslim migrants to be brought into Germany, because according to him, there is a risk of inbreeding amongst the German people. Those were his words, not mine. And he also said, quote, "For us, Muslims in Germany are an enrichment of our openness and diversity." So he's openly calling.
All right, stop. This is a two bombshell. Again, we broke all this on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Drudge magnified it. It forced mainstream news worldwide to report exactly what we said. They confirmed it. Just showing we have the real sources. Paul, I don't know about this leak. I know about my sources. I know you're getting some on the ground there. Did you get this? Was it Skelton? This is bombshell. Are we getting leaks right now from the current meeting? Because I just got from folks that work for one of them what was on the agenda last week before they went, which was international news. Are you saying you're getting leaks right now in real time? Because I think I'm about to have a you-know-what dream. Go ahead.
Well, it's the same every year. You know, we've got leaks that come out from our inside sources, and we've got what they're saying in public. He's saying in public that he's going to threaten UK again with economic terrorism.
So that's Der Spiegel, but tell me about the leak. I'm salivating.
Well, the leak that he's there, and this is what he's saying in public, and this is what they're talking about at the Bilderberg meeting. And he's echoing, you know, what Stephanie von Berg, the Green Party head, said back a few months ago.
She said it's good to get rid of white people. You know, Germans are bad.
Calling for Germans to be a minority in their own cities within 20 years and saying that that's a good thing.
Because that's right. And this is the beachheads, folks. This is the beachheads. They blew up the Middle East. They transshipped the people in to invade Syria. They shipped them through Turkey. They're blowing wide open Macedonia as the main corridors. They're bringing them in to make you a minority and an enemy. These people being brought in will be your minders and your controllers, okay? And a lot of them are just victims of it as well, but they are the new political minion class. You're being replaced, and they'll be replaced with robots as well. This is all just the collapse phase we're going into, Paul.
And basically what we're seeing in Germany now is a massive re-education program. In fact, there's an article out today which I tweeted where they're taking students, putting them on an island, and re-educating them to sympathize with the migrants. That was, I think we posted it.
That's right. Germans now, if I pull that up, I have that in the stack. I can't find it right now. Germans, that's not the headline, of course. It's like, oh, sensitivity training on islands for the migrants. No. German children being sent to re-education camps to prepare them for open borders. Just like the Army Manual, 2010, declassified 3 years ago, says re-education camps for right-wingers. It actually says re-education camps and uses a Soviet term. Paul, this is insane. That's why I looked at all the news this morning and just went into a hissy fit. I mean, this is crazy. This is really happening.
It's completely insane. You've also got a program which is teaching migrants how to flirt with German girls. You've got programs in the schools. You've got senior politicians calling for Arabic to be mandatory in German public schools. This is a huge re-education campaign. And whether you think the migrant influx is good or not, the migrant should have to integrate into German society, not the other way around. That's not how it's supposed to work. So you've got that going on. You've got Merkel demanding that the guy who arrested the migrant in the store who was behaving erratically, trashing the store, trying to steal a bottle of wine. You've got Merkel demanding that he be arrested, not arrested, but kicked out of her party unless he apologizes for basically stopping a criminal. So this is a massive re-education campaign that's taking place in Germany, and it's really beginning to intensify. And a Bilderberg member who is at this meeting is calling for that same very re-education program. So that's what they're talking about here in Dresden.
And by the way, Paul, I saw that article this morning. They're hiring the former Stasi to enforce on everybody to not criticize the open borders. They're giving people tickets or arresting them, then hand out flyers pointing it out. I mean, this was a takeover. And I know, but what was the headline on that article? Because I had it in my stack. I can't find it. I'd forgotten that. I want to show people. They're now sending German school children, high school students, and college students to re-education camps where they cannot get away over their summer vacation to be put in with migrants, bossing them around and social engineering and saying have sex with them. I mean, folks, this is so hardcore. I mean, this is unbelievable. And this is what Obama's chief of staff said he wanted in that C-SPAN interview. Rahm Emanuel said, we're going to have a national security force just as big, just as strong as our military. He quoted Obama. But then he went on to say, when you get out of high school, you'll have 1 to 3 years mandatory national service, but not in the military. No, that's dangerous enough because they can be political. Yet domestically, as social justice warriors, as community organizers, but first you're going to be brainwashed for 1 year, then 2 years of on-the-street service. They are building literal Soviet youth brigades. Stay there, Paul. Tell us during the break the headline. I'm freaking out right now. I mean, folks, I knew this was all coming. I knew this was all coming, but to actually see it here and to know it, and to know that the new Alamo Drafthouse Theater they're building in Austin is going to have one giant bathroom with men and women in it, with women urinating in urinals standing up. I mean, I'm just saying, it's total psychological warfare. We've only seen the beginning. Flesh-eating bacteria, TB, death everywhere, covering it up. I mean, it's just insane. This is total war. World War IV has begun. This is World War IV. It's World War IV. It's like the government's aliens or something. It's so high-tech. Just wake up. I am letting myself get hysterical on air because that's the normal response to the type of dehumanization and the dystopia the globalists admit they're building on purpose. A dystopia for us, a supposed utopia for them. But we're not going quietly into the night. It's Breitbart reporting on it. And the headline should be re-education camp, but Breitbart's great. But again, you're not supposed to say that because it's too much. School kids forced to play migrants to better understand them, and then they're sent. It talks about the island that they're on for refugee of the day. Again, this is re-education camp garbage. And then look at these headlines. I'm going back to Paul Watson in Dresden and then to Rob Dube for his take, and I'm going to get into other news. Exclusive, Bilderberg planning to trigger financial collapse. Paul Joseph Watson from Inside Intel, over the top incredible, should be the top story in the world. And it dovetails with today's news. Let me just show you this since I mentioned it earlier. Wall Street Journal, stocks drop as government bond yields hit fresh lows. Wall Street Journal, CNBC, why big investors think it's time to hoard gold. A summer panic is starting to brew across markets. Market Watch, former Fed president, all my very rich friends are holding a lot of cash. Forbes, out is out, Schnabel warns of single market access in event of Brexit. We will not allow you to trade in our country if you leave. We are an unelected bureaucracy. You do not vote to enter. And if you try to leave, we will shut off your trade. We are in control now. You will submit and take the vaccines. Then you will feel much better. Just take the shots and eat the food and shut your mouth and die. This is our world now. Lay down and die. Humans are bad, hurt Earth. Accelerate genetic engineering. Ready the spacecraft. I mean, these people are out of control. Where is your humanity? Get your spirit of Survival rising! Stop being living dead, waddling around like penguins. I was watching Trump just 5 minutes ago during the break with the operatives trying to shut down his rally, his speech, his policy speech, beating people up outside as usual. He's pointing out 500% increase in the refugees they've announced with no vetting. IDs aren't even looked at. That's admitted. TB, everything. Ah, but we love you. But when you fly, say, from Austin to New York, oh, we're going to put you through a body scanner and ask you questions and have you take your shoes off. It's like, you know, getting a cat wet. Get you all naked and teach you how to submit, because this is just the first level of you learning. We're going to learn you good. And, of course, the TSA and the cops, they don't know what's going on. They're just like the general public. Maybe the cops do, because the cops supposedly have the skills of reduction and of logic. And I found why they want to make us enemies with the police. They want the police to do their bidding, be on a short leash, bring in their new world order, but they fear them because they're criminals historically, the globalists are, so they want us attacking the police to make them be against the people and vice versa, because I found the cops are the easiest people to get through to and wake up after special forces people. It's because if you're actually in special forces, the military for that matter, or you're in on the street, which can be a combat role just in and of itself, you better live in the real world. You're going to get hurt real fast. And so here's the news. We're living in the Twilight Zone, baby. I don't know what to do about it except get the word out, not comply with unconstitutional garbage, and take action and just it's energetic. We have to have the energy. We have to be loud. We have to be aggressive. We have to never stop and promote the truth. It's the info that's key. But we got to get people out of their trance. How do you wake somebody up? Won't wake up? Dump ice water on them, baby. We need an ice bucket challenge. In fact, I'm doing an ice bucket challenge next week, to wake up America and the world. I'm going to redouble my efforts, folks, because this is so serious. All right, going back to Paul Joseph Watson. I mean, Watson, it is crazy. Exclusive Bilderberg member confronted, says secrecy of Bilderberg is essential. Sanders sojourns the White House, vows to support Clinton and fight against Trump. George Soros is preparing for economic collapse. Does he know something we don't? Well, yeah, he's running it. I mean, this is just getting crazier. Trump rejects Obama endorsing Clinton. He just wants 4 more years. Paul Joseph Watson, continuing with other tidbits from Bilderberg as the camera crew pans around and shows TV viewers what's happening there in Dresden. I'm going to get a short comment from Du and then let you guys get back to your important work.
Well, another aspect to come out of this, Alex, we've talked about how Bilderberg is moving towards, you know, the Silicon Valley angle with Facebook reps, Palantir reps, etc. Well, another big story came out today, which was that Google, which of course is owned by, headed up by Eric Schmidt, who is here right now, Google is censoring searches for Hillary Clinton criminal. So if you go to Google and type in Hillary C-R-I-M, you're going to come up with Hillary Clinton crime bill 1994, not Hillary Clinton criminal investigation, which is what now the White House spokesman said is that's what the FBI is treating it as. So now they've caught Google actually censoring negative searches.
That's huge. And that's Google who's at the White House even more than Facebook. That is huge, Paul. In fact, I saw that earlier. Let's do it on screen for TV viewers. Radio listeners, go to Google, type in Hillary Clinton criminal, and then they block the fact that they are now saying it's a criminal investigation with her crime bill. Wow. But of course, that blew up in their face. And now they've been caught. They've had to back off. In fact, I'll play that clip in a moment, but go ahead, Paul.
Yeah, I remember they tried to do it with Twitter with a hashtag, a negative hashtag about Hillary that beat the trend, and it got shut down. And, you know, Schmidt has been an advisor to the Obama administration. He was the founder of the Groundwork, which was a Silicon Valley company dedicated to putting Hillary in the White House. Last year, we got the leak that Hillary was the chosen candidate and they were going to start scheming to defund her Republican opponents. Now Trump's come out of the blue, self-funded, so they couldn't control that. So this is another way in which they're going to bury Hillary Clinton's criminal conduct, crooked Hillary. And, you know, Schmidt is here, and obviously that is one angle that they're going to be talking about. The other issue is Cologne. Of course, we had the mass molestation of women in Germany, in Cologne, Germany, on New Year's Eve. The media didn't report on it for 3 days afterwards. It circulated on social media. Massive police cover-up.
Then they said it was white Germans doing it in phase two, then later had to admit the police were ordered to cover up.
Well, here's the breaking news. You know, at first they said, oh, these weren't refugees, these weren't migrants. And people were like, well, oh, so they were integrated. So these were assimilated people. Well, that's even worse. But now it's come out, most of the culprits of that mass molestation in Cologne had been in Germany for less than 12 months. They were economic migrants. Most of them were refugees. Two-thirds of them, of those involved in the mass molestation in Cologne on New Year's Eve, had committed a crime, again, despite only being in the country for 12 months.
Sure, let me just interrupt. We're not supposed to call them illegal aliens. Then it's illegals. Then it's undocumented. Then it's migrants. This is all UN terms to teach us to be under a global government. We're all poor and stupid except for the elite. How about the new word be little precious angel darlings? So little precious angel darlings, the new word is not migrant, folks. It's little angel cake, darling, perfect sweetie pies. Go ahead, Paul.
And again, you know, we spoke to the guy from Nepal yesterday. That's a video that everyone should check out on the Alex Jones channel. He was a legal immigrant, came to Germany to stay in Dresden, has been here for 4 years, speaks perfect German, speaks perfect English, and he's not happy about the way, for example, that Pegida's being characterized by the media. He's not happy about the amount of people being brought into the country. And listen to this statement from the spokeswoman for the German Interior Minister. This is what she said when these new stats came out. Quote, immigrants are not as criminal as Germans. How's that for a statement when it came out that they're responsible for twice the number of crimes in respect to their population?
And that's with police whitewashing. In Sweden, the police were ordered, if it's a migrant of color, just say, you know, say native Swede. So they've been, even with cooked numbers, they're engaged in half.
Yeah, so again, it's all part of this re-education program. They're covering it up, they're lying to the German people, and they're now forcing, as we covered earlier, students to go and live on islands to be mistreated so they have sympathy with the migrants. So there's a massive brainwashing program going on with this. It also came out that most of the individuals responsible for the incidents in Cologne were from Tunisia, Algeria, and Morocco. So they were from North Africa. Again, this is the big problem that these crime statistics show, that most of the crimes are being carried out by people from North Africa, from countries like Morocco, where people go on holiday. I mean, it's not a war-torn country.
Sure, let me expand on this and ask you another question. You got a lot to do, a lot of articles to file, other breaking news that's just coming on Infowars.com on an hourly basis. How big a victory? Because I want us to, you know, not just be negative about what's happening. That's what the globalists are launching on all fronts, because they're actually behind, in my view. How big is it, though, that Bilderberg's being exposed at a level never before seen? I'd say 3-4 times as much this year than before. The fact that they're running things to a great extent is happening. The fact that there is a shadow government. I mean, that always leads to the end of any shadow dictatorship. As soon as the power behind the throne, as soon as the conspiracy is exposed, historically, I mean, I would say right now, we have turned the tide against the New World Order. And I think all their offensives are really defensive moves, like the Nazi offensive in the Battle of the Bulge and the Ardennes.
No, that's exactly it. I mean, the headline on Drudge, which was our headline a few days ago, was populist panic. That's what they're in a panic about. You see what's going on with Trump in the United States? They don't control him. Whatever you think of his policies or his rhetoric, he's self-funded. He's outside of the control of these people. That's what makes them nervous. These people are control freaks. Any political development that they don't have their hands on, it scares them to death, which is now why we're seeing the economic threats with Brexit, because again, that would represent a huge rejection of everything that these people have built for 50, 60 years. Remember, we got the BBC documents out from 1955, which showed that Bilderberg wanted to create the EU, wanted to create the euro single currency.
They did. These are the people charting the Anglo-American establishment that runs about 70% of the world right now and wants world government. The communist Chinese are allied with them to a limited extent because they want to run it themselves. The Russians aren't. And I'm not saying the Russians are perfect, but you notice Russia's never been part of Bilderberg. The globalists basically overthrew Russia with the communist movement to destabilize it. Russia has finally thrown that giant spider off its back, and the globalists are very upset with Russia.
Yeah, that's exactly it. I mean, there have been statements on the record from top globalists over the past couple of years that, you know, quote, Russia is no longer in the New World Order, and statements like that. So they want a unipolar world, whereas other countries, the BRICS countries, for example, want a multipolar world, and that tends to work out better for freedom, better for privacy. Of course, they have complete privacy inside this hotel, which is surrounded by a massive exclusion zone.
But we don't.
Reporters. But we don't. We don't have any privacy. They're going to dig into our lives. They're going to dig into our emails. We think, yet they expect to get privacy every time they meet in secret for this lobbying confab, which is what it is, which is what Tillich admitted to us last night.
Well, simply incredible, Paul. You guys are, this is the best job you've ever done. To all the crew, to our graphics people, to the people running the show, everybody, amazing job. Paul, we're going to go to break. I want to come back and do two quick segments with Rob Due. Then I'm going to shift gears into Peter Schiff joining us on the huge developments of the economy. So important. And then we've got a very informed person, Tim Kennedy, coming here to talk about COG, talk about destabilization campaigns and more. Thank you, Paul. Joseph Watson, great job. In 20 seconds, anything else?
No, there's going to be a huge protest tomorrow, left versus right. There could be violence, there could be clashes, so we're going to be on top of that all day tomorrow.
Yeah, I really want you guys to stay back because I want to be able to get the full conference. I know Friday's a key day, but just please, I know you guys have a lot of fearlessness, but I just don't want you guys to get thrown into German jail. So please try to hang back, but I mean, don't get hit with rubber bullets like Jakari. I mean, or Biggs, because I think this is going to get pretty bad tomorrow.
Okay, we'll do that. And then Saturday, some of them like to go walkabout. So that might be an interesting angle to pursue in terms of getting more information out of actual.
Sure. Well, I want to salute everybody that's there. Godspeed, Paul. We'll talk to Rob Due next. Briefly, folks, speaking of Hillary, criminal investigation being censored on Google searches, and that's been confirmed. Now they've backed off because they got caught. It's an ongoing battle, folks. Resistance and engagement is what defeats them. So don't think because they're always after us, we're losing. No, this is fun. It's like weightlifting. We're going to get stronger here. It's like jogging. We're going to get better. We give up, they win. We never give up, we win. And we become stronger and empowered and live in legend instead of living like jellyfish. Get your Hillary for prison shirts. They hate this idea. We're so close. When we come back, Josh Earnest is, I'm going to play the clip, you know, admitting, yeah, no, it's now criminal. They've tried to spin that. They tried to say it isn't. That means something big's about to happen, folks. Get your Hillary for prison, limited edition. When this shirt sells out, no more of this shirt. A new variant's going to come out, and that will be the final edition of these because, you know, obviously she's going to go to prison or, you know, next she's just going to be impeach Hillary if she gets elected president or indict Hillary or, you know, pray for the fall of Hillary. I don't know. Infowarsstore.com. They cannot censor you wearing a shirt out on the street, or it's much, 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 much harder than digital. They hate this. You meet like-minded people, other patriots, and the small profit we make helps fund this very expensive project that is sending in salvos every day that are devastating the world government project. And they just don't know what to do. Because the best laid plans of mice and men often go astray. And Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall and Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. This is a Kit Daniels article up on Infowars.com. You cannot make this up. Canada legalizes oral sex with pets. Sex offender acquitted by a bestiality involving peanut butter. Next, it'll be you're allowed to marry your pets, and next you'll have to have fire hydrants at the Alamo Drafthouse movie theaters or wherever your movie theaters are in case you think you're a dog. I'm not joking. Canada's Supreme Court has legalized oral sex with pets as long as no penetration is involved in a ruling slammed by animal rights group. A 7-1 in favor ruling. That means Canada has legalized Bill Clinton having sex with Hillary Clinton. All right, a horrible joke meant for the media to pick it up. Go ahead, White House Media Matters. She's a war criminal killer. He's a sex offender, in my view. These are horrible perverts. And so I think it's fair to put them all of their ilk into this joke. But I apologize to dogs or gerbils, for that matter, or cats or lizards, I guess. Any pet, turtles, into the same slugs, into the same category as Herr Hitlery. Briefly, they're trying to censor more and more. It's all over the news. We need to have an email to contact you for breaking news, analysis, videos, information, promo codes for the shopping cart. Infowars.com/newsletter. Go there, put in your emails. We can stay in contact with you. A lot of huge discounts we send to you as well. We had like 50% off on t-shirts just a few weeks ago for folks that were on there with a promo code. So really need to be a member of the InfoWars Insider Newsletter at InfoWars.com/newsletter. Separately, emails in Clinton probe dealt with planned drone strikes. Couldn't be more classified. And then meanwhile, Josh Earnest now admits it is a criminal investigation. That's coming up. But I wanted to also just remind everybody that we sold out of Living Defense. I always end up plugging at the end of the hour. I'm going to stop doing this plug earlier because I run out of time. I realize I haven't plugged anything. And we fund our operation by selling these products, plus they're the very best we can bring you. Living Defense is like 20, almost 30 known organic ingredients that flush out parasites, harmful organism cleansing, 120 capsules. Check it out, InfoWarsLife.com. We ordered three times as much this time. Took us 6 months to get it because it's all has to pass California standards. We want to be the highest standards. That's almost impossible to do. And it's 25% off out of the gate, so it's selling out at a rate like four or five times what we thought. And so it'll be sold out by the middle of the end of next week. In fact, I may just raise the price back up to normal just so we don't sell out of it for 6 months. That'd be a better business decision to fund our operation. But right now, it's there at the discounted price, $34.95, 120 capsules, InfoWarsLife.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. I wonder if the government in Canada will legalize sex with parasites. Now, that would make it legal for Hillary and Bill to have Chelsea. But reportedly, Chelsea's Webster Hubble's daughter, so what do you know? And, of course, Michelle Obama looks like a snapping turtle. So, but you know, it's the fact that she eats all this great gourmet food and wants you to eat stuff worse than prisoner foods. Why I don't like Michelle Obama. And why is the first lady telling us what to eat? We're going to break here in a moment and come back with Rob Dubit. Rob, what are your observations? Doing a great job there in Dresden at the Bilderberg meeting covering it. What are your observations the last 24 hours, my compadre?
Well, last night, right around dinner time, I got a text saying, hey, there's a chance for a confrontation for the governor of Saxony. So I grabbed all my stuff. I literally had flip-flops and a T-shirt on. I run down to where the church is, get my gear on. My friend Tillman was there with his camera. And immediately as he came out, we ambushed him, asking him questions about Bilderberg. I said, is it about bringing more migrants into Dresden? He didn't want to answer that. But before all that happened, Our friend Max Bachman was able to get him inside and get him to admit basically everything we've been talking about. It's a giant money grab. That's what Bilderberg is, to ways to funnel money.
A giant money grab that created the euro, wants to run our country. Stay there, back in 70 seconds. Third hour straight ahead. Tim Kennedy and more. All right, let's go to Rob Dew, InfoWars Nightly News Director, reporter on the ground in Dresden. Go ahead and finish up your report going out there and getting one of the Bilderberg members. This has been a devastating year for Bilderberg. They have got to be upset. And they are like cornered rats inside that facility, Rob.
Yeah, in fact, Paul and I talked about this today in another report. What is going to happen to this man now that he's kind of spilled the beans on Bilderberg? He was just getting into the kids' table. He will probably not be groomed for anything future, unlike what we saw with Bill Clinton and Tony Blair, both who were able to rise to prominence and world leadership after attending their respective Bilderberg meetings. Also, I want to talk about the young lady and man who were arrested for holding a cardboard sign, possessing bread, and a tent. Well, they were brought out to a park out a little ways from here and kept in the sun for hours, and they were spread-eagled the whole time. They had to sit spread-eagled, and anytime they tried to close their legs to get comfortable, they were told to bring them back open. The guy was punched and kicked several times. She was released, and even though she was being handcuffed and detained, they said she was never arrested. Then they took the man to jail. He finally got released early this morning.
Boy, these are real men.
For literally cardboard, bread, and a tent. And that's what it's come down to. We also went to the pizzeria where we got a tip about they wanted to have 24-hour access to this man's pizzeria, not even connected to the hotel. There's actually a road in between them. But they were also bringing furniture through there. We went and asked him about that. We had to go through a translator, and the guy looked at us and said, no comment. And he put his head down and walked away. So he obviously is hiding something. And finally, Lindsey Graham, as far as we know, has not appeared here at the meeting yet. We did call his office today, and they confirmed he would be going, and he was actually speaking on the Senate floor.
But he may be dressed as a woman, though, Rob.
So that's true. That's true. But we do plan on asking him, and when we do see him, what are his plans to subvert a Trump presidency? Because he's crossing party lines, working with Democratic operatives that are here, the big financiers, and we're going to see what his plans are, and hopefully we can get a comment from him. I've already contacted
his press
secretary.
Well, and of course, you've got the big left-right battle coming up tomorrow. You've got Bilderberg likes to sneak out and walk around. What else are you looking for?
Well, those would be the main things. And also, we are searching for the migrant camps in the area. That's always an ongoing mission that we've been doing.
They try to hide them, and, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. They do. And the Germans are very good at hiding them. They put them in nondescript buildings. We do know what their fencing looks like, the fencing they like to use in the company that puts it up. So
I haven't seen any drone footage yet. Is the drone operating properly?
The drone is operating properly, but in here in Germany, with all the police crawling around, it is definitely a punishable offense by being arrested. So I don't know if we're going to get any drone footage at this time, but we do have footage.
Don't know if it's illegal. Certainly not. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Jones, we do have footage of Wolfenstein Castle via drone that is simply amazing. So stay tuned for that. We're going to do a whole report on the history of it. We've just been so busy gathering intel and confronting the scallywags of the Bilderberg Group.
Well, you've done well, my friend. We salute the InfoWars reporters out there on the ground and all of you that support us and make this possible via radio and TV. Thank you so much, Rob. We'll be back on the economy. This is really key intel straight ahead. Tim Kennedy's back there. He's already worked out for like 3 hours this morning and shot for 2 hours. And he's coming on the show at 1:30. And he's back there in Anthony's office while they're having meetings on the drawing board about TV shows and survival programs we want to do. And he's in red, white, and blue underwear, boxers, like just trying to rest so that he can come in here and do the show. And then he's going to go work out again later today. I guess we're turning into a barracks or something. But I tell you, we've got to get geared up and get prepared. And more, we're going to have shows on shooting, shows on survival, programs on you name it, because things are getting crazy. And Tim Kennedy is the soldier, not just one of the top middle heavyweights in the UFC. I mean, the guy, of course, is one of the most highly decorated guys out there. A lot of secret, the highest level units that he obviously can't talk about. But it's great to have him as a consultant and, you know, popping in on the show. He's also one of the hosts of Hunting Hitler and a bunch of other big TV programs he's got lined up. But he lives right here in Austin. He loves the show. He's a patriot. And so we're talking about some of that exciting stuff with him coming up at the bottom of the hour. Speaking of getting prepared, stocks drop as government bond yields hit fresh lows. Wall Street Journal, why big money investors think it's time to hoard gold. CNBC, a summer panic is starting to brew across markets. Market Watch, Forbes, former Fed president, all my very rich friends are holding a lot of cash. And it just goes on from there. Meanwhile, Schnabel of Germany, minister, warns the EU, or warns the UK not to leave the unelected EU that they didn't vote to get into, or they'll just cut them off completely. Well, I mean, that's the parasites threatening the host. Meanwhile, exclusive, Bilderberg planning to trigger financial collapse. The last time we said that was 2006. We're on record, my film Endgame came out a year before the 2008 situation. They said they're going to trigger the housing collapse to bring in a consolidation of control. And you know what? We were proven right. Well, our same sources say they're getting ready for it right now. So that is a big, big deal. We just confronted a Bilderberg group member yesterday that was outside the hotel in Dresden. Also, George Soros preparing for financial collapse. Does he know something you don't? Michael Snyder, Economic Collapse blog up on InfoWars.com. So I like some of the other guests we have on. I'd say they're about 90% accurate, like Mr. Dent. But we've been the last year or so saying who would be right about this? Who would be right and say that oil prices would start going back up? Who would be right to say gold prices in the aggregate this year would start going back up? Who would be correct about all that? And I would say overall, I'm not poo-pooing anybody, I would say that Peter Schiff has been more accurate than anybody else we've interviewed. And we only have folks on that are about 90% accurate or more. So it's not like it's bad to not be as accurate. But it is a big debate, though, about are we going to have inflation or deflation? I'm not a rocket scientist, but when they're printing more money and issuing more garbage and more derivatives than any time in history, worse than 2008, tells me down the road, paper's going to have a problem. But now you're talking about holding your money, so liquid whatever is what you want in my little, you know, brain. But who knows? Peter Schiff of Euro Pacific Capital joins us, billions under management, and, of course, son of the famous patriot fighting the IRS and the corrupt government, Erwin Schiff, who passed recently. He joins us to discuss all this, Europac.com. So there's your little intro. You've been dead on. Let's just revisit your predictions, where we're at currently, and your next flotilla of predictions, Peter, but congratulations on being accurate. Though it's kind of like congratulations, you know, you're predicting the Titanic just hit an iceberg and we're going to sink. So what do we do?
Well, you know, I still think it's early even to congratulate me, and I'm not going to, you know, take credit prematurely But it sure does seem like things are proceeding according to the playbook that I laid out. You know, even though people still believe that the Fed is going to be raising interest rates at some point and that we have a legitimate recovery, the dollar is still falling. More importantly, gold is rising. Gold stocks, again, pretty much all the gold stocks hit new 52-week highs yesterday. And here we have today with the Dow down about 150, the Nasdaq's down over 70 points. Gold is up yet again. It was up a little higher earlier this morning, but the trend is still there. And, you know, you talk about all these people who believe that there's no consequences from the last 8 years or 7 years of 0% interest rates and three rounds of quantitative easing. How can anybody believe that there is not a bill that's coming due for all that? Because if you look at what Alan Greenspan did, we had interest rates at 1% for not even 2 years, and then we gradually raised them back up above 5% over a couple of years. No quantitative easing programs at all. So what Alan Greenspan did was very mild compared to what Bernanke and Yellen have done. Yet the consequences, the payback for that monetary policy was the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression.
Sure, and even with cut numbers, they're saying 1.8% economy. I mean, what's the real economy? Negative 2%?
Who knows how negative it is? Because the numbers aren't real because the inflation rate is being artificially suppressed. But my point is, if we had such a bad consequence of the reckless policies under Greenspan, just imagine what's in store for us now. I mean, this is not just going to be the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression. This is going to be the worst crisis, including the Great Depression, because what we're about to enter into, and I think we've already entered into, the beginning of it, but I think it's going to get a lot worse as it progresses. But this is going to be greater than the Great Depression. Meanwhile, you've got President Obama and all sorts of Democratic, talking heads out there.
Bernie Sanders.
Talk about how great this economy is.
And Bernie Sanders running around like an idiot.
Oh, yeah. Look, you know, we had this awful jobs report last Friday. Not only was it way below estimates, they revised down the prior month. We had another mass exodus of workers out of the labor force to get the labor force participation rate back down to the lowest it's been since the early 1970s before women entered the workforce. So if you look at the labor force participation rate for men, it's the lowest it's been in the history of the republic. And so this has been a disaster. And all of these so-called economists who are Democrats who are trying to say that, you know, the Republicans are wrong for criticizing the economy. If a Republican had been president for the last 7 years and everything was exactly the same, can you imagine what they'd be saying about the rise in income inequality, the rise in poverty, the collapse in real wages, the collapse in home ownership, the mass exodus out of the labor force? I mean, this is statistically the worst economy really in our lifetimes. Yet because there's a Democrat president, nobody wants to criticize him from the left.
Well, the show isn't about who's right and who's wrong. It's about knowing the future and getting prepared, obviously. And we'll talk some about that. But, I mean, you did say you thought oil would start going back up.
And
you did predict that they would, basically start talking about going back, to QE Unlimited. You predicted how they would go up when they went up. But you've also been predicting that, gold would go back up. I know they're trying to artificially suppress it, but, worldwide, the demand's going back up. And they admit in elite publications that, indeed, the, quote, elite are hoarding cash, gold, you name it, building armored bunkers at record levels. Yeah. I mean, what have these people done?
Well, the price of oil has almost doubled from its low. It got back above 50. In fact, I saw it as high as about 51.60. It's since pulled back below 50, back in the 49s. But the trend now, I think, is up, and it's going to be even bigger once the dollar really starts to cave in. I mean, the dollar index still hasn't broken down. It's going down. But I think, again, people are still holding out hope.
Sure. What's the time frame? I know you don't want to go out on a limb, but just you're one of the most accurate guys out there. What's the time frame? What do you really think when you sit around the coffee table talking to your wife?
Well, it doesn't matter. I think it's happening right now. When it's going to accelerate, from a march to a stampede, I think people have to protect themselves now. I mean, look at our strategies. Look at how much gold stocks went up or silver stocks. Talk about gold and silver. I mean, you're talking about stocks that have tripled, quadrupled so far this year, and Wall Street still doesn't own them. So this, I think, is still early in the scheme of things. So what your listeners to do, if they didn't follow my advice, 3 months ago and 6 months ago to get on this train, you haven't missed it. I mean, you still got to get on. You got to get out of U.S. dollars, get out of U.S. stocks. You should be talking to my representatives at Euro Pacific Capital. Set up an account. Take your depreciating dollars before they really collapse and diversify abroad. Get some money into Switzerland and Singapore and New Zealand.
And by the way, Peter Schiff is not a sponsor. I ought to call him, give him to be one. I mean, I think the guy's a great guy, but I mean, I do agree people should be diversifying. But, I mean, look, let me ask you this question then, Peter. Looking at the time frame historically here, I understand it's already here in most of the world. It's already here in the U.S. at a trot, and you're talking about a gallop, a stampede. What's the time frame, though? I mean, I know you don't, I mean, speculatively.
You know, I think the election could be a catalyst because I think one of the reasons that Janet Yellen is reluctant to admit how weak the economy is because she doesn't want to interrupt the Hillary Clinton narrative. I mean, the
That's
whole
right.
idea that Obama saved us, everything is great, and now we should turn over the reins to Hillary.
So we're in la-la land until the election ends.
Yeah, I mean, but thing is, things are getting so bad. Can the Fed hold out and still pretend everything is good until the election? But certainly by the time the election is over, there's no reason to put up the pretense. So I think by the end of the year, the Fed's going to have to come to the rescue, at least what it thinks is the rescue. They're going to cut rates. They're going to try to have some kind of QE program. But again, this is pouring gasoline on a fire. None of this is going to help solve our problems. This is why we have a problem. The Federal Reserve has created this problem, and they make it worse.
I agree. Let me ask you a politically selfish question, but the audience wants to know. I'm worried Trump's going to get in, and then they're going to hold the collapse back till then and then blame it on him.
Well, look, I don't think they'll be able to blame it on Trump if it happens, you know, right when he walks into the office. But I think the crisis is going to happen regardless of who we elect. I do think that Trump has a better chance of doing the right thing than Hillary. Hillary has no chance of doing the right thing. Trump might. See, it all depends on, you know, he does a good job of identifying the problem. His solutions are all wrong. Now, maybe he knows they're wrong. Maybe he's just playing politics.
Sure, because he wants low interest rates.
The real solution.
He wants low interest rates because he's a builder. We'll be right back. We've got our guest here, Peter Schiff, joining us, EuroPacificCapital.com. He's been dead on so far, so we're going to come back, and I'm going to ask him, what's front and center on his radar, not just my question. Stay with us. Folks, please remember we are listener-supported radio, not like NPR that gets government money and then Rockefeller money and then begs for money, and you give them $100, you get a coffee cup. I think you give us like $8, you get a coffee cup. We make $4 on it. If it's a Hillary for President shirt or it's great nutraceutical products at InfoWarsStore.com or shortwave radio or non-GMO heirloom seeds for your garden, all of its things at really good prices, some cases that beats out Amazon, and then the profit we make funds this operation. So it's a free will, free association, shop with the good guys situation. So thank you all for your support at InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And we do have the Living Defense anti-parasite formula back in stock after being sold out for 6 months. Unfortunately, it's selling so fast, it'll be gone at this rate by next week. So if you never took advantage of that, do that. Peter Schiff of Euro Pacific Capital. Instead of me asking the questions here in the 5 minutes we have left, you've got the floor. What's front and center for you?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, it's when are people going to wake up? You know, I was on this, guys, I was on CNBC a couple days ago, and still they acknowledge that, okay, things seem to be slowing down. They're not as good as we thought they were, but they still don't understand the gravity of this situation. They still have no clue how much damage has been done to the U.S. economy these last 7 years. They still have confidence, have faith in the Federal Reserve, have faith in the dollar, believe everything is going to be okay. And they just think, well, we're at a little bump in the road. They don't realize that we've run out of road, or the road has now come to the end and we're going over a cliff. That is actually what's going on. And to me, this is more obvious than the problems that I was warning about in 2007 that it came to a head in 2008. Yet all the people who were oblivious back then are equally clueless now. And to me, this should be even more obvious, especially since we just have that example of what happened in 2008 fresh in everybody's mind, even though it's still, what, 8 years ago. It's all the same people. They were here. They lived through it. It's not like they had to learn about it in a history book. This isn't like the Great Depression, where it's very easy Wow. for a revisionist textbook to learn the wrong thing. We experienced this ourselves. Yet we're still not prepared for what's about to happen, which, again, is going to be much worse than the 08 financial crisis. And it's going to be a dollar crisis. It's going to ultimately be a sovereign debt crisis. And it's going to bring this whole bubble economy to its knees. And Americans are not going to be able to get away with this anymore. We can't just keep pretending we have a real economy. We just can't keep running trade deficits and borrowing money to pay for imported products. Meanwhile, we have a bunch of people who are pretending to work.
100 million people that don't work.
Aren't even pretending.
Peter Schiff, okay, everything you said is totally true. 2 + 2 = 4. You've been absolutely right. Here's the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey would say. They're not going to follow common sense like you just said and stop pretending. I think they'll get even worse, nationalize things, start wars. I mean, historically, they'll make the wrong decisions to stay in power. So what do you expect them to do? I mean, look what they did in 2008. Make it worse, give themselves trillions.
I expect them to make the wrong decisions until they can't do it anymore. I mean, eventually, the market won't give them any more rope. We will have hung ourselves on the rope we already had. So at some point, we're going to do the right thing. But my portfolio, what I'm doing with my clients, I'm betting that they keep doing the wrong thing because there's no indication they're going to do the right thing. So what are they going to do? They're just going to print more money. They're going to take interest rates down. These clowns are probably even going to try negative interest rates, even though they're not working in Europe and they're not working in Japan. They're dumb enough to do it because when it comes to central bankers, if one of your friends jumps off a bridge, well, you jump off the same bridge because everybody is doing it.
Lemmings.
So it must be the right thing to do.
Lemmings. Wow. And look, what you're doing with your bet is risky, but it's not. I mean, it's risky in that short term, it looks scary, but we know historically there's no way they can extend this forever, no matter how much voodoo they've got.
I don't even think it looks scary in the short run because it's already unfolding. Yeah, right. The dollar is already going down. Gold is already going up.
No, you're right. The Fed has said they're out of bullets. The Fed has admitted it isn't working.
Yeah, well, I mean, but the thing is, their bullets never worked, but they're not out. They have a machine gun. They can print as much money as they want. If they actually think money printing works, there's no limit to how much they can print.
But they admit it's not working, so how do they have the cake and eat it, too? I mean, you've seen the statements. They go, no, this isn't working. We're out of bullets. So what does that mean?
No. They've never admitted that. They still believe their policies were a success. That's how clueless they are. They still believe that their policy.
I've seen a few statements where they've admitted it's not working. I mean, I've seen some statements, but no, I mean, you're right. Then they kind of like out of one side, they go, this isn't working. But then out of the bullhorn, they say it is.
No, they don't accept responsibility for their role in inflating the housing bubble. They don't accept their blame for the financial crisis. They still believe that all their policies were correct. And so the next time the economy turns down, they're going to do it all over again. See, they're still pretending we have a recovery.
All right, Peter, you've been dead on. Thank you so much, Europac.com. Have a great weekend. I'm going to try to start getting my family ready. I tell you, he's back there in the green room. Tim Kennedy coming here to talk about economic collapse, preparedness, why we're really joining forces to try to get people rallied and awake. Yes, folks, there he is with Joe Biggs back there salivating over Joe Biggs' new sniper rifle. I feel sorry for the social justice warriors. I think they're putting us in re-education camps. We'll be back. Ladies and gentlemen, we're facing a Red Dawn scenario, a sneak attack scenario, but not from Cuba right now. We're facing it from big globalist combines like Bilderberg and Davos and George Soros, who admit they're bringing in a planetary world government where they make the rules, they pick the winners and the losers. And where Homeland Security for 8 years under Obama, it had some problems before, but under Obama, gun owners, veterans, conservatives, libertarians are the number one enemies. As they bring in massive amounts, it's not in the tens of thousands, folks. They're covering up the number, just like they cover up the illegals. The Border Patrol tells us they complete the smuggling process. It's got to be in the hundreds of thousands of refugees here, 5 million in Europe. They're just ignoring all the laws. They let people in that have TB. Our government is acting like it's actually out to get us because it's not our government, in my view. And we have seen the last 4 years, you heard it here first with our guest, Cy Hirsch and Colonel Schaefer and many others, that our own military said, we're not going to back al-Qaeda in Syria. They started giving the intel to the Russians. Now, you knew that 4 years ago here. That was declassified in the last 6 months. That was released in the press in the last 6 months. So the good news is there's still America left that's following the Constitution, the Bill of Rights to a certain extent, and you've got criminal alien globalist groups from outside this nation that are absolutely preparing to bring down this nation and the rest of the world in a financial, economic collapse, warfare, you name it, all the ingredients are there. So, Tim Kennedy, who is known as a UFC fighter, I mean, I know better because I follow actual what's going on in the country, that you know, he's one of the most experienced special forces soldiers ever, many, many, many tours around the world, some of the most classified elite units, which qualify him to talk about COG destabilization programs because they study them on both sides. And when he came in a few weeks ago and said they're planning destabilization and collapse, that doesn't mean they're going to totally implement it, but it means it's being looked at, and it's not just on the drawing board, it's being moved forward right now. And he can correct me if I'm wrong, but from all my information and just studying this in our context, this is like a 9 on a Richter scale. Previous stuff was a 2 or 3. This is all the alarm bells are going off. All the political sensors are going off. The elites are running around like chickens with their heads cut off. They're weaponizing the media now more than ever. They're pulling out all the stops, in my view. And so, I mean, I'll just tell the story and then give him the floor. It's hard to shut me up. But he was already here today doing some work with us, so I said, please come in. That Shane Steiner, I've known him since high school. These guys have been training together for a few years. Got to know him. We talked about preparedness. He talked about how I should go out and, do some training and just get prepared for what's unfolding. And then the more and more we talked, we just said, well, why not actually produce some internet tutorials that are also exciting and entertaining so folks watch them on how to get ready and how to get prepared and how to promote a true patriot or dangerous freedom are your terms, culture that is the antithesis of this jellyfish coward culture, emasculated male, disempowered female. So just a pro-human force multiplication that you're so well-trained in that I've organically developed to reach out and empower the American people to resist by becoming healthy and involved and being leaders, and that will automatically counterbalance the attempts they've engaged in to make us all domesticated. And so we're launching this True Patriot Initiative that you'll see roll out in the next few weeks and next few months on top of your incredible schedule and mine and UFC and special things you're doing on the side and hunting Hitler. I mean, you're a guy that works 18 hours a day. It's going to be around somebody that has more energy than I do. Tim Kennedy, it's great to have you here with us.
Thanks for having me.
All right, so you got the floor. Tell us about True Patriot and where we stand and where this country's going, because as things get so bad, and as the situation gets bad, you're going to see more and more alliances and more patriots coming together with the courage you've got to be associated with InfoWars, my friend.
Yeah, it's scary sometimes, but it's exciting. You know, True Patriot is it's this idea that we're going to empower people to, for the first time, grab onto what it means to be a patriot. Like the loose assumption that we can just live our life in liberty, that we can grab our freedom and do whatever we want, it can never be realized. Unless you train, unless you prepare, unless you understand what individual responsibility looks like. So a True Patriot, you know, if you go to infowars.com/True Patriot, we are rolling out not only tutorials, not only impassioned truth-telling videos, but we're giving you the skills to be just that, an individual that can live its life in liberty and freedom. We're showing you how to shoot. We're showing you how to grow your own food. We're showing you how to exercise every single one of those beautiful amendments that were written by our founding fathers. You know, they were brilliant. They were geniuses, but they knew what was coming and they knew what they had just fought in 1776 and they never wanted to see that again. So they wrote these things and said, you have to be able to, just like a muscle, exercise these frequently, because if you don't, they die. And that's what True Patriot is. We are passionate in this idea of freedom and liberty. You know, I have been to countries that believe in socialism, that try to enact communism. They don't work, right? The one thing that we know works is freedom. And I've fought for it. I've killed for it. I've bled for it. Now I sweat for it. Now I teach it. And you have to buy onto this idea and believe it and train it every single day. And that takes hard work. And that's what True Patriot is.
Well, there's the saying, you talk the talk, you walk the walk. And it's absolutely true. We have to physically go out and plant gardens. We have to physically spend time with our children. We have to physically turn the TV off. We have to physically go for a jog. We have to physically stop eating GMO. If we do all those physical things, then the mind awakens and turns on. Then we'll go to city council. Then we'll run for office.
Yeah.
But we have to physically get out of the malaise that so many patriots are in physically, myself included, a long journey from just totally only being cerebral and gaining like 80 pounds and getting totally out of shape. And I used to be in great shape. It's been a slow journey, but I've gotten back in probably 90% back to where I was. And again, then I'm that much better at fighting the globalists. And, you know, as you guys have done in the Green Berets and the Special Forces, going behind enemy lines in occupied tyrannical nations, organizing the people to resist tyranny. You know, the motto, to paraphrase it, is free the oppressed, defend the oppressed.
It's the oppressed, the oppressed will obey. Yeah, it's to free freers of the oppressed.
And so getting back to that, yeah, our government may be run by criminals, and we may be going into a world government, but America's still alive. All of us are seeds. And Tim Kennedy's a big seed. I'm a seed. You're a big seed to grow the mighty oak. And to have somebody like Tim Kennedy here, activating in America in the real battle for the Republic is a true leadership model to everybody else in the military and out of the military. Because, you know, obviously in the Pentagon, you're one of their top, you know, promoters, patriots, you know, one of their big names out there. Here you are on your own with InfoWars, knowing what you're doing because the country's in so much trouble, folks. And you're going to see more of this. People are in the government who are good. Most of them are good. And corporations are good. They have just been compartmentalized. They've been taught they don't have any power. But Tim's motivated. Yeah, he's a super soldier. He won't tell you that himself, but he's the best there is. I've been told by the other folks in the military, and he's here to defend the Republic. But I want to ask you a question. What are you doing now? Because, listen, I don't do this because I'm some hero. I do this because instinctively I can't be run over and be a slave without standing up. I'm just a regular guy 20-something years ago, got involved, and see where we are. Imagine when Tim gets involved and you get involved. We're looking to win this thing, not just be, you know, overrun and defeated or, you know, hide out in the woods. We're going to go out and take this country back.
Hey, you hit the nail on the head when you said it takes work. It is so easy to control a populace that is weak and that's pathetic, that they have no skills to do anything. They have to rely on somebody else. You have to have somebody give you a phone because you can't earn enough money to go get one for yourself. You don't even know how to grow food. You don't know how to change your oil. You are literally living your life as a slave. So individual responsibility, you know, it's the idea of dangerous freedom. I would prefer dangerous freedom over peaceful slavery. Slavery is, no, it's not in chains. I'm out picking cotton. That's not what I'm saying. When you give every single bit of who you are and the strength of your person to somebody else and make them provide what you need, your substance.
Let's show Trigglypuff. I know you almost cry. So I mean, we laugh because we're uncomfortable. We're not pleased the social justice warriors that can't talk and just scream racist. We're not pleased to see Trigglypuff that's like, you know, 4'9" and weighs 300 pounds and sucking a bottle, screaming ban free speech. We are threatened by the masses of dangerous lemmings like them that'll run us and our families over a totalitarian cliff. And we're here, as Paul Revere's, to say now is the time to reactivate and take action.
Yeah. You know, my safe zone, it's about 2,000 meters, because that's how far I can shoot. You know, I train that. I work that. And all the way from 2,000 back to 5 meters, every single different range setting, I'm pretty efficient with a gun. So my safe zone, it's not you know, saying a word that I'm uncomfortable with. It's me training and being knowing that I'm proficient to provide for my family and make sure that they're safe. And that's my safe zone.
Well, think about this. They have university studies. You can pull them up. 7 million people died of starvation or in association with starvation from malnutrition, the Great Depression. We were 90% rural. Half the folks roughly were totally self-sufficient. The others partially. We are now 89% urban. And of the 11% that are rural, less than half are self-sufficient. 5% of the country is self-sufficient. I'm not self-sufficient compared to my dad, who grew up on a farm, and he's a doctor. But my dad can fix anything. I am an idiot compared to my dad. He is nothing compared to his dad. We are becoming jellyfish.
Yeah, but it's never too late. You know, that's why I'm saying, just right now, what are you doing? Where are you doing your research? What are you doing with your day? What time are you getting up? What time are you going to bed? We were built to go to bed tired. You're not supposed to sit in your chair.
You have more energy when you bust your ass. I've got a study right here. Go ahead.
It's like the doors are opened, right? You're living, you got the blue pill, you got the red pill. One is you're going to live in slavery and you have no idea what's going on. They're just going to provide substance for you. The other one is this realization, this existential experience. And the more that you do it, every time that you train, every time that you work, every time that you exercise one of those freedoms, it's like another layer of these blocks.
I have more energy than when I was 18. I can't even hardly stand it. The more data I get and the more I realize I'm resisting tyranny but building something good, it's like I'm genetically meant to do it. And my brain and body goes, good, you're doing what you're supposed to. Here's all this energy and power. Boom.
They want you to be lemmings. They want you to be powerless. They want you to have no individual responsibility. They don't want you to know how to grow food. They don't want you to know how to change your oil. They don't want you to know how to shoot.
That's what's manly. Taking care of your kids, being a good father, being healthy.
That's it, exactly. You know, you want to talk about being a good parent? It's believing and knowing that you're doing everything in your power to ensure that they're safe and have everything that they need. Not a teacher, not a principal, not the government. That's not their job to raise your kids. It's your job. You raise them, you educate them, you give them their morals, you give them what, teach them what justice is. That is your job. Don't give that away. And that has to be hard work. And every single time that you start working hard at one thing, the stronger you get and the weaker they get. The stronger we are as a people, the weaker they are. believe it and start doing it.
That's right. And who are we? I mean, what is a true patriot in your view? And I think your view is just it's true. It's prima facie. It's not some secret we found. We're not cult leaders. We're not special. Other than the fact that they've so enslaved people and put them in a trance, this is seen as bizarre right here, pure Americana. I'm seen as weird for being upset about them. The federal court just ruled they can ban our guns in public. You can't have a gun out in public. I mean, this is serious. That was yesterday, folks.
A patriot is somebody that has the ability and the strength of will to live their life how they want to. Not somebody tell me what I can do. With that, there's an assumption that you are giving away some of the security, some of the safety that can be provided. I'm saying, I don't want you to help me live my life.
Free range humans?
That's it. Leave me alone.
Well, we know it sounds good to live in this controlled box, but people die. They turn into jellyfish. The brain dies. The body dies. They admit it. Humanity is in deep trouble. Every metric shows disease, ignorance. It's all exploding.
They can't control people that can do things on their own.
You know, a bully goes to the mall and sees a bunch of shuffling wimps who don't even know about their surroundings and thinks, you know, oh, I'm a criminal. Great, I can feed on them. But somebody like you, we've talked about this. How upsetting is it to go see, and I don't think of myself as really tough or smart or anything, but compared to these people, I'm alive, they're dead. What is it like for you, one of the most highly trained people, works out probably the hardest in the world, you know, what is it like for you to see how domesticated they are?
I just see weakness. It's not that I look at them and I feel sorry for them. I see an opportunity to plant a seed because I have hope. You know, hope is not a plan. You know, that is, we had people running on that idea.
But at least you're optimistic.
Yeah, there's a chance. The soil is fertile right now. It can be cultivated. I am planting seeds. Every single time that you watch one of my videos, that you go to Infowars.com/truepatriot and you watch something, I'm planting a seed in your mind to go out and work, to go out and shoot, to go to the range, to practice free speech, to go and figure out how to, what the difference between alternate current and direct current is and how that works in your electrical system. You're like, go do something that makes you stronger.
Find out where the meat comes from. I mean, you guys have gone out. I mean, separately, we kind of had the idea for this a few months ago because you and Shane and others were just going out to visit, you know, Mennonites making their own milk to make a deal to get your own milk weekly or going out to, like, you know, see about a co-op about, you know, raising vegetables. That is so human, so manly. That's what it's really all about. Not strutting into some bar and, you know, acting tough. I'm not saying it's bad to go to a bar, folks, but you know what I mean? We've got to get balanced and actually get back to the soil. I'm going to skip this break. This is so important. Everything the globalists are doing is about taking us out of our natural environment. Why is that?
Because it makes us weaker. You know, in the United States, I was talking to my sister. I was like, hey, where's the best place to get natural milk? I just want milk from a cow to give my family. Or I want to go look at the farmer. I want to meet the cows, make sure I got nice, clean, healthy source. And she's like, well, you know, it's illegal in most states. I'm like, what? Wait, I can't even buy milk from a cow.
Of course, you come from farmers in California.
Yeah. Like, this is how I was growing up. It's normal. I could just go drink milk. I'm going to make cheese. We can get butter. But it's illegal in like 42 of
the states. Big reason why you're a lot more healthy, though, is you grew up in a farm and didn't even know you were escaping everything.
Do you even know where your food comes from? Do you have any idea? Do you go and meet the animal that you're going to put in your body? Do you have any idea? Do you just walk into the grocery store, don't care about what steroids are in it, what the government puts in it, or blindness.
And again, I know our audience, most of them actually know this, and nobody's bad. I'm still, you know, not doing the things I should do most of the time, but I've turned the ship around. I've changed the direction. This is about getting our audience to also carry this message with powerful videos, informational, on to others that there is hope, and lifestyle change isn't just about looking good, you know, like all these TV shows and things say. It's about taking your country back, starting with your body, with your family, but also a lot of hardcore, you know, pro-America political messages as well. So we're sitting here talking. You're already going out to, you know, talk to these Amish or whatever. You're already going out to do this. Why don't we send a camera crew? Why don't we go show urban farming that's going on right here in Austin, Texas? Why don't we show what true sustainability is, not this phony UN garbage? I mean, talk some more about your plans with this, because I'd say 80% of this is your brainchild.
It's so easy to do. You know, people are scared. What does it mean to be able to be self-sufficient? You know, I'm talking solar power. How do you do that? I'm going to show you. You know, like, How do I go and set up my own urban farm? We have farms here in Atascadero, that's where I grew up. We had 1 acre parcels, and we had community farming where one person would grow one thing, the neighbor would grow another, and then would share, and everybody had enough to survive. And then you come into here, Austin, Texas, a huge cosmopolitan gigantic city, and we have tons, hundreds, maybe even thousands of people that are now turning the page and saying, no, I'm going to grow everything that I need here on my own home. I'm going to have goats. I'm going to get their milk. I'm going to have cows. Just eat. Like,
and by the way, that checkmates the whole globalist corporate model that is designed to make us independent. Exactly. So, and why is this happening spontaneously? Just in the last 3-4 months, we started talking about this because we instinctively can see and then look at the news and see everything's unraveling. They're getting ready to do bail-ins. You look at these giant cities, they're time bombs. The food is just-in-time delivery. Within a day, everything's off the shelves. We already see riots all over the world. Things are degenerating quickly. We're not just here saying move to the country and have a year's supply of food. That you'll die in a year if that's the case. If things really collapse, which we're trying to stop, you will need to know how to fight, how to move, how to communicate, at least how to identify other patriots. This is how they intend to totally control us, and it's gone from being a possibility to a probability. Tim, I mean, I know you can't get into classified stuff, but clearly COG, ramp up for civil emergency, ramp up for martial law, all over the world is accelerating.
Without a doubt. You know, it's frightening to look at what 15 years ago, when I first went to Special Forces, and the things that we were training, you know, we're talking direct action, hostage rescue, specific time-sensitive targets type things, to in the recent days where we're doing a lot of civil unrest, where we're looking for destabilization and planning for both how to do it and what to do if it happens. You know, from as a patriot, as a libertarian, scares the dog shit out of me.
We'll bleep that, but absolutely. And as somebody trained, because Delta Force under Clinton did do destabilization in 1999 in Seattle to set a precedent, to, you know, with that training, now you're trained for destabilization, also how to counter it. You can then sit back and we see destabilization going on, don't we?
Yeah, but that is why it's so important. You know, you can't control something that doesn't need you. I don't need anything from anyone. We are completely self-sufficient. Food, water, shooting, self-defense, everything in my home and my family is protected and provided for. So I don't need them to give me anything.
Oh, listen, I've got to learn all this now because I know more than, you know, the basic domesticated guy, but nothing compared to my dad. My dad at like 67 is like a robot that can build a house, build anything, fix cars, fix machinery, build fences, grow food great, cook dinner great, skin things super quick. And I'm like, this guy's like a combat robot when it comes to like building things and doing things. And his dad was like that. And I'm like an idiot. And I really feel guilty that I'm not passing that on to my son. So that's why I want to try to do your sheepdog training. I want to get involved. I want to try to just not sit here and say, I know everything, but I'm going on the journey of trying to be more of a good father and a human.
That's it. You said journey. That's what it is. You know, it's a daily dedication to this journey of being free.
And my dad loves cooking and loves fixing things. He's like, he's excited. He gets off on it. And I'd be like a kid, oh God, more chores. Dad, he loves to clean the garage. He loves to help somebody change a tire. He like, but I just realized that's what a man's like.
Yep. And you're going to have access to how to do it. Right, you know, right here. You know, not only do you want to learn how to do it, but you're going to own it. You know, it's going to be part of what, if you want to understand what a patriot is, what being a real libertarian is, it's being free. And being free means you have to work to have that freedom. It's not free. Freedom is not free. So we're going to have how to skin an animal. We're going to have self-defense videos. You know, we're going to have sheepdog courses that anybody can come to. We're going to have how to grow your own food.
And it's not about having a monopoly on it or we're the best. It's that we're putting the alarm out. Hey, the founders were self-sufficient. That's why they could kick butt. Okay, and again, the whole enemy plan is about us being domesticated. We have to start moving in the other direction. Everybody already instinctually picks this up. Now's the time.
It could not be more of an important time than right now. Has to be right now. We can't wait another day. We have to do it right now. You can come and watch our videos. Film your own videos. If you have a farm, go grab a community. It's about community.
We'll feature your. We'll come out to your farm.
We will. But it has to grab your neighbors, grab your friends, grab the people from your church, grab the people from your golf club. I don't care who it is. Grab people and get them involved.
Not just America, but the human condition is under attack. We're going into servile bondage, artificial synthetic world. We're breaking the matrix, folks. We're coming out of it.
Freedom is addictive. It is. When you get your first taste of what liberty truly feels like, I mean, it's the greatest hit in the
world. Animating contest of liberty.
Opens your eyes and all you want to do is have more of it. And anytime you see that is being restrained, it infuriates you. When you get passionate about this, believe it, start doing it, fall in love with it and grab everybody you know and with open arms.
That's right. They want to control us with Cloward and Pippin. They want to collapse society where we're getting food from them out of the back of a truck. And look, even if they accelerate the collapse and this message doesn't get out there completely, it doesn't matter. It's the seeds in the long-term battle that will defeat them.
Yeah. Right now, the soil is fertile. It is waiting for somebody to come and cultivate it. And that's what we're doing. We're giving you the information. We're planting the seeds, and those trees are going
to
grow.
And we have to believe we can change the world. We already are. Look at how InfoWars alone, we're just one small part of this, has dominated Bilderberg, forced world government out in the open. And it's gone from us being national news every month to every day. And it's not a power trip. It's actually, though, a great responsibility to know that we're sitting here in an organization that is one of the strongest points of liberty in the world. The enemy makes fun of us. They attack us. They try to demoralize us because they're scared of us, because they know they're globalists to come in and hijack this nation. We got 5 minutes in the next segment. But, Tim, the website's Infowars.com/TruePatriot. There's some promotional video stuff up there, but this is just the launch. A lot of stuff coming up next week.
Yes, sir. We have videos, more videos being released. We're shooting more videos. It's nonstop. We're going around the world. We're giving you the access to the best information on the planet with the
great. Yeah, don't let them in on that. Are we going to have footage from overseas? Oh, my gosh. We'll be back. Stay with us. I'm Alex Jones, the fourth hour straight ahead. We can't get into the behind-the-scenes stuff that nothing classified, but stuff Tim's telling me about. A little bit of heat, you know, from some of the brass whenever he comes on the show. But most people in the military are really good patriots. The mainstream media will misrepresent what I say about Jade Helm and then say, Alex Jones says there's martial law in 2015. And then we never said that. They just misrepresent. And then some people in the military hear that and think, oh, Alex is saying bull. But the truth is, if you actually follow what we say, then people know it's dead on.
Yeah. We're never going to agree on anything. And I don't think any adult is going to be able to say, we agree on everything. That's we're individual minds, and that's totally fine. You know, but what we both believe in is liberty and freedom, and we're going to do everything that we can to push that envelope to its hopefully breaking point.
Absolutely. Tim Kennedy's our guest here. We've got David Knight taking over in the next segment. It's been an amazing broadcast so far, but some really cool stuff you guys have shot. There's the 1 minute promo piece that we can play here in the background without audio. Or maybe with the audio of you guys, you know, rappelling out of helicopters and sharpshooting and, you know, doing, you know, yoga, you name it, just all fusing it together. But give us some other examples of some of the projects.
You know, we go into a lot about the liability and assets of you as an individual. You know, what are the weaknesses and strengths of you as a person? Are you strong? Are you healthy? Do you have good food? Is there a balance between, I'm not saying like serenity, yin yang stuff. I'm saying like just as a person, are you a healthy person? Because the chassis, you as a person has to be healthy for you to be able to reach out and to do more things. If that's weak, then you can't do anything. It seems like it's crazy and outlandish that people are rappelling out of helicopters, that people are...
I like your war face, but you got the handgun and the dagger.
I think the camera guy was like, so what do you think about people taking your guns away? And that's what that scene was. I was just like, no, not a chance. Not a chance. No, I love freedom too much. You're not going to get those. And the reason that we have all of the other ones is because of our freedom.
Let me ask you this in closing. There's an acceleration, obviously, in preparation for collapse. Do you think there's a way to stop the collapse? I mean, I've got a stack of mainstream news here saying collapse today. I mean, I don't want to collapse. I hope it's not coming.
No. So how you stop a collapse is to build a strong foundation. And what's the foundation of this country? It's the people, right? So the people have to be strong. Right now, we are weak.
So you're trying to stop the collapse.
That's exactly what I'm doing. That's what True Patriot is. I'm giving people the opportunity to become stronger as individuals with individual responsibility, with the assumption of risk that I'm going to work hard, that I'm going to be a productive member of society, that I'm going to pay my taxes, my fair share of taxes, not 45%, my fair share. Then we as a people become strong. The foundation becomes strong. The collapse can't happen because we as a people are strong.
That's right. They're trying to overwhelm us. The globalists want that to happen. In closing, and we're shooting some other stuff today. I appreciate all your time. I know a lot of people. I mean, I used to 15 years ago go, the military's trying to take over. So I was mad at the military, not at military people themselves, but, you know, that the military was being trained for this. I didn't realize that the military was some of the most awake people. Now they're super awake from what I've experienced. The police are super awake from what I've experienced. That's why Soros is going after them. What is your experience? I mean, how many guys in special forces say are pretty much aligned with your views?
I think every one of them. I mean, there'll be a weirdo out there every once in a while, you know, that like I love their beautiful minds, and it's a great perspective because, you know, the guys that are coming from some of the Ivy League schools, Special Forces is a very unique group of guys because everyone's way too educated. They're way too smart to be shooters. And so you have this intellectual, cognitive group of dudes, 12 of them, that are always arguing back and forth. But the vast majority, 80, 90, 95% are all barrel-chested freedom fighters.
We got a couple videos to shoot, but I'm going to go to break, come back and do 5 more minutes, then pass the baton to David Knight, because I want to get more into this, because the most group, the group that I see that's the most awake is the patriots in this country. So it's kind of this paradox where the globalists want to use the military to carry out their world government takeover, but then it's the military that's the most awake and the biggest supporters of the Constitution, Bill of Rights, and who actually put it all on the line because they do believe in something. So you have this scum running things with these wonderful people under them that are basically enforcing this. How do you deal with that paradox? Tim Kennedy, we'll be right back. Tim Kennedy's my guest for a few more minutes, and then we're going to hand the baton to David Knight. But he's planning some really exciting stuff, actually going out, reporting for us. But not just reporting as, you know, standing up talking, but looking at the scenes, looking at what's happening, you know, basically getting people to start thinking outside the box, like somebody in Special Forces would do, or like the globalists would do, because Special Forces is doing it to try to, you know, win the fight or protect the people. The globalists are looking at it and how to control the population. That's why they want you in a zombie state. So, Tim, talking more about that.
Man, go to a supermarket. Go to Walmart and look at people. Look at their eyes are down. They have no idea what's going on around.
You're
going
to go on Walmart and show that.
Yeah.
With hidden cameras.
Yeah. So in one of our sheepdog courses, I actually take you to supermarkets. We walk around, and I when we come outside, I say, you know, where do you think this person lives? Pointing at a car and just looking at the bumper stickers, we're like, oh, that person lives in this community. Their kids go to this school. They're part of this club. And then we watch the person come out of the supermarket, head down to the shopping cart. They don't even see the 10 of us standing next to their car because they're so self-centered and ethnocentric. And
they think being self-centered, that's how they're winners. We've been taught only caring about yourself.
Yeah, weak. That's what it is.
Or they twist it and go care about others, give up your life to the government. Well, no, that's self-centered too. It's just bizarre.
Yeah. So I'm excited when I say go exercise your freedoms. It's not just, you know, your right to bear arms. It's not just being able to buy raw milk. It's also your freedom of speech. It's also your freedom of religion. You know, it's also
you got to exercise everything like muscles or lose it.
Yes. Yep.
So there's a report out actually on that today. Yeah. There's a report out showing that people that are really busy doing a lot of things, they live longer, they have higher cognitive ability, they're more fulfilled, they have a better sex life, everything. I mean, they're alive, other people are dead. Why time-starved people are happier.
Yeah. Man, I feel so sorry. Like, I feel bad for people that get up, do the 9-to-5, come home, have a beer, crash on the couch, watch some football, just get all this stuff that is getting put into their brain and into their body is toilet. It's trash. And then you look at like me and my friends, my group, my community, you know, the Jake Signs, the Shane Steiners, you, like these guys, we live life at a different level. We experience so much more. We do so much more. And I have nothing but like sympathy for
well, don't compare me to you guys physically, but I do work at night, do a lot of other stuff, and it's empowering. And as I've started exercising more, I've had even more energy. And my life's just so good, it's crazy. But it is a scary paradox because all these jellyfish and folks are so self-centered. They're so unhappy. They're so depressed. They admit they are. So they get more lazy, more self-centered, and buy more into the trendiness. They're total prisoners. I just want to see them free. The average jellyfish gets off on somebody dumber than them. It makes them feel good. It makes me hurt.
Yeah. It breaks my heart. And especially when they get to the point where they're in so much pain physically and emotionally. Now they're going to the pharmaceuticals and saying, hey, I need this because I feel so depressed. Or they're going to the psychologists that went to schools that are completely controlled by the world.
That's the trap. Briefly before you go, let's get more into the military because we were talking about this. That is so exciting to hear. I've said 95% of the active duty or recently out Special Forces folks, I don't care if it's the Navy, the Marines, you know, the Army, whatever it is, they are the most awake, charged up patriots that are fully aware of every angle. I find the police have big problems. They've been globalized. They've been put under different edicts. Some of them are bad. The culture's degenerating. But I wondered why George Soros and others were trying to stir up this war with the police, because they want to federalize them with their Strong Cities UN initiative. This is a real takeover, folks. Okay, so I realize, well, they're the second most awake group. I mean, I was always wondering why, even though I'd bash the police a lot when they were doing bad stuff and projected onto all of them, say 10 years ago when I wasn't more sophisticated, they were still so many times big listeners and would just kind of smile at me and say, you'll wake up someday. even though they do a lot of bad stuff because they're given those orders, and I'm not defending that, they're the next most awake group. Is that an accurate statement?
Yeah, it is. You know, when we become soldiers, we raise our right hand and we say that we're going to protect the Constitution, foreign, domestic. That is protect the Constitution. The Constitution is the document that empowers us, that gives us those freedoms. So when you want to talk about a group, a populace that is awake, that is alive, it's because they have sworn their life to death to protect the one document that gives us our freedoms and liberties. That is the most important thing to me and to all of my friends. It's the Constitution.
So how does that paradox work where we've got such incredible corruption at the top? I mean, undisputed pure evil now in both parties, but really bad with the Democrats. I mean, that's really rotten. You can smell it from here. And then you've got such great people that are actually under it. But now I've learned so many times just quietly not going along with the agenda. That's not mutiny. When your country's been hijacked, that's duty, isn't it?
Yeah, it's not like we're disobeying orders, but we know what the right thing is and we do the right thing. You know, I'm not over there killing people so we have oil. And I'm like over there killing so we have an opportunity to put somebody that we believe might be more negotiating to our ideas. I'm killing really bad people. And so we make a difference.
You can't tell us, but you personally killed some pretty famous terrorists, I've been told, not by others.
Yeah, I mean, I've been in Special Forces for 15 years. I've been a Special Forces sniper, a ranger, you know, Green Beret. I'd be really bad at my job if I hadn't killed bad dudes. I'd be like the worst guy ever. It's like a mechanic that.
And you knew Chris Kyle.
Yeah, we worked same place at the same time and deployed on the same missions.
I mean, obviously it's Hollywood, but generally, how accurate is that movie?
He was a very, 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 very talented sniper. You know, he believed in protecting his soldiers, and that's what a sniper does.
And I'm told in competition, you're one of the top snipers in the world, are you not?
I get beat sometimes, but not often. I shoot 3-4 days a week and compete at the highest level in sniper competitions.
Did you ever compete against Kyle just out there at the base?
Or? No.
I know he was a SEAL, but you were Army. But
yeah, we a very healthy rivalry.
Sure. Well, then looking at that, And obviously you follow orders. What I was talking about, and of course you know about this, 4 years ago, General Dempsey, then chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, he and other admirals and generals, they went to the White House, and I was told this a week after it happened, and it was years later until it was confirmed. And Cy Hirsch came on the show and said, no, you broke that. That was true, because we had Colonel Schaefer, but other sources off record that gave us even more, that they went, we're not going to be the Air Force for Al-Qaeda. We're not going to do this. Then Rand Paul came out and Ted Cruz months later and, you know, said that. But it was the military itself that actually went and said, we're not going to go over there and kill Christians. We're not going to back ISIS and Al-Qaeda. And those people like Tosh Plumlee blew the whistle. It was a CIA contractor, you know, talking about that. So that's a big deal that really since Benghazi and on, the military has been saying no to criminal orders. And I know you don't want to sit here and say that on air. That was above you where that happened. But what type of discussions were there in the military when that happened?
And we know what's right and wrong. We know what's just and unjust. We know what freedom looks like. And we know what the Constitution stands for because we swore to protect it. And we're going to do everything in our power, both, you know, passively within our ranks or officially through the channels that we can, or in battles. We're going to do everything that we can to do the right thing. You know, they're you're not gonna like. Look at them. I got the most awesome shorts in the world right now. That's we love freedom, and you're not gonna like put us behind a desk in front of a microphone or in front of a bunch of generals. We're gonna say this exact same thing.
And by the way, you didn't know you were gonna be on today. You were up here working after you worked out, and like you were back there just resting after a huge what 3-hour workout, about to shoot some videos. And I said, can you come on the air? So that's why there's a suit on top and American flag.
Anybody have a jacket? I got my gun in my pocket. I got my awesome tennis shorts.
I'll walk in and go, hey, quit napping. You're going on air.
What? All right, I'll get to work.
A poor Special Forces soldier just wants some rest, and I won't let him. Yeah. All right, we got 3 minutes. We got a break, and I'm going to hand it over to David Knight. Again, there's just some basic videos that are pretty powerful up at Infowars.com / True Patriot, Dangerous Patriot. You'd rather have the dangers of freedom than the security of slavery. But history shows, as Benjamin Franklin said, when you give up liberty for supposed security, you get and deserve neither. I mean, the most insecure thing is being a jellyfish.
Yeah. And right now, it's just getting started. The True Patriot, you know, those are teasers. Those are like, hey, look at this. Get passionate. Believe in this idea. Get emotional about this.
We're about to flood the site with it.
Yeah, you're going to get more. This is just the beginning. Like, when is the next thing coming? As fast as we can do it. As much as we've already shot a ton, there's a lot more coming. So just get excited. Grab your friends, grab everybody that you know, and get on the idea, get on the train of liberty.
All right, brother. We'll stay right there. We're about to go to break. And in that, I know you didn't want to plug it earlier. I said, hey, plug the other stuff you're involved in. I mean, this is an info war, and we need people to support what we're doing, whether it's the sheepdog training, which I know is always over full, or you know, whether it's your work with Ranger Up, great, amazing Patriot clothing. And then also you've got all the other stuff you're doing, you know, lead the charge there with UFC. What are the best places for folks to find Tim Kennedy information?
Tim Kennedy MMA on most social media platforms. You know, like when I say community, like I reach out and find the groups of people that are part like you. Like we, even the shoes I wear, Whoobies, like it's made by Special Forces guys. Like I can deadlift in them. I can jump out of helicopters with them. Like
I want a pair of those.
I'll give you a pair, whatever. Everything about my life is symbiotic. And so, you know, hop on board, get on, follow InfoWars, follow me, Tim Kennedy MMA, both on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat. Facebook, obviously, but you're going to get a ton of true patriot from me. That's all you get. Go.
Well, ahead. I'm just excited because it's great. You're used to organizing stuff and leading it. I can just turn you loose and you're just all the stuff we've been shooting. They've been shooting is amazing.
Yeah.
And the great work Shane Steiner and the crew. My only problem is I need to hire more camera people. We are so overwhelmed. And also it takes money to produce all this. We have this living defense that we only had in stock one time. And it all sold out, so I produced three times more. It's got like 27 ingredients that pass California standards. So you know, the air has more lead in it than they allow to be in a product. So this is as clean as it gets. But it took us 6 months to finally get all the ingredients and have them all tested clean. That's what costs us so much money is the triple testing and on each ingredient. It's killing us. But we do it to have the very best products out there. Plus, we know we're targets. So this will flush the parasites out like nothing you've seen. It's so good for your kids. You name it. Adult takes three. A child would take one. Consult your physician first. It'll sell out by next week. And the profit we make helps fund this operation that's trying to defend human liberty. InfoWarsLife.com. InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella site. You get 10% off with AutoShip when you sign up for AutoShip on any product. And free shipping on orders of $50 or more. And by the way, this is discounted 25%, even though I don't need to. It's such a hot product. I didn't realize how hot. I'm going to have to take that special off because I don't want to be out of this for 3 or 4 months again. Tim Kennedy, God bless you. It's great to have you involved, sir.
God bless America.
Absolutely. This is a very exciting time. Hey, the challenge of tyranny is here, and men and women everywhere are standing up to resist it in their red, white, and blue boxer pants.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show in this fourth hour, Friday, June 10th. I'm David Knight. We're going to talk about what's going on in Bilderberg, and especially, I guess you could call it the Precariat Part 2. We're going to talk about the plan to make you the Eloi, as I mentioned in the short 1 minute when we talked about this. Got to understand this thing called universal basic income is something that's being pushed not only by the utopian socialist left, but it's being pushed by the Wall Street Journal, by Forbes, even by the economist Charles Murray. Remember back in the 1980s, I think it was 1984, he talked about Losing Ground was the name of his book, talking about how welfare made people dependent. And it was the basis of a lot of welfare reforms. Now they're talking about a universal basic income, which will make everyone dependents of the state. And it's even being pushed by the American Enterprise Institute. You would think the American Enterprise Institute would value the idea, the traditional idea of work and reward. But no, they are pushing for a nanny state that is going to care for you from cradle to grave to build a dependency like we've seen. Them shut down the activities of Indians when they put them on the reservation. Now, this is not anything new. This is something that's been coming around for quite some time. It is an idea of both the left and the right, because you know what, folks? There is no left and right. We see this over and over again. At the top, they all push globalism. They're all pushing a universal basic income to make you dependent upon the state. The American Enterprise Institute's run by the Koch brothers, okay? So we're going to talk about what the Koch brothers have in common with the communists. This is a moment in history, like when the German central bankers, one of whom the head of the central bank and his brother was creating the Federal Reserve at the same time in America with those who were plotting to do that at Jekyll Island. But the head of the German central bank took Vladimir Lenin, put him on a train with $10 million in gold and sent him into Russia to start the communist revolution. Oh, who would have thought that the German bankers would create the Russian Communist Revolution. You see, there's a lot of phony opposition. There's a lot of phony dichotomy, the idea that we've got the people on the right versus the people on the left, and we've got capitalists versus these. When they get to the top, all of this stuff that they divide you into, they just ignore that. They all have a common agenda. And you can see this even with the terms that are being used by these the economists. Things like the precariat sounds like the proletariat, right? The secretariat. The solitariat. Yeah, they're going to give you a secretariat. They're going to give you a secretariat to rule the world. So all this stuff, the billionaire space race that we're looking at, the Artelec war that we've talked about in the past with Hugo de Garis, the coming singularity, artificial intelligence taking 90% to 95% of the jobs, all of that is why these business people are joining with the utopian socialists to propose a control of you. How are they going to stop this? You see, Brexit is a good example of how the common people are grabbing their pitchforks and their torches, and they're going to burn down this thing that the Bilderberg helped to create, which is United States of Europe, on the way to creating a world government, on the way to creating the kind of government that you saw portrayed in the movie Elysium. Colonies in near space, where they have a monopoly of manufacturing, of energy, where they tell you what to do, when they enact Agenda 21, packing you into very close confined quarters in the cities, keeping the rest of the Earth off limits to everyone but them, and then having them remove themselves to space colonies where you can't get at them and take them down. See, this has all been talked about in many different ways, and it is all coming together. There is a singularity, and it's not just a technological singularity. There is a political and economic singularity that's coming. So we're going to talk about that. But first, let's talk about Hillary Clinton, because she's one of the players in this for sure. Now, there's an article on The New American, came out yesterday, TPP and the new Clinton email scandal. Hillary Clinton is embroiled in yet another email scandal. This one deals with emails that would show her involvement in and advocacy for the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Now, she's telling us, well, yeah, I was for it before, but now I'm against it. It's just a facade, folks. It's just a facade. For those of you in the Democrat Party, don't be misled by this. She is for the TPP. She's campaigned saying she is not in favor of it, but she was before, and evidence shows that she was for it before she was against it. And you can even see that in what the State Department was doing with her. For those of you on the left, those of you who are Bernie Sanders supporters, look at what happened with the Keystone Pipeline. It was the State Department that was under Hillary Clinton that was pushing so hard for that. I mean, even Obama didn't want to spend the political capital to sign on to the Keystone Pipeline. And of course, that is a massive piece of crony capitalism and eminent domain, giving a Canadian corporation the power to condemn property in the United States. I have no problem with the environmental aspects of using oil. I favor it, but I don't favor crony capitalism and eminent domain by multinational foreign corporations. And that's what that's about that I oppose. We're going to talk about Hillary some more when we come back. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this fourth hour, Friday, June 10th, 2016. We're going to cover some Hillary Clinton news. We're also going to cover, I want to get to Bilderberg and talk about one of the topics that they mentioned that they're going to talk about. Of course, they're going to talk about, they're not going to really tell you what they're really talking about in many cases. Most of the stuff is kind of general boilerplate. It's very non-interesting, most of the topics that they put up. Of course, they're going to talk about China. Of course, they're going to talk about Russia. They didn't even say that they were going to talk about Brexit. But of course, you know they're going to be talking about that in detail. And you know they're going to be talking about Donald Trump in detail. So they didn't mention Donald Trump. They didn't mention Brexit. You know that's going to be part of what they're talking about. But one of the things that they did talk about is something that's really been accelerating in public over the last couple of years. It's something I've seen it go back now as far as 2010. I don't know how long these socialist economists have been talking about it, but I think the amazing thing about this universal basic income, an unconditional welfare payment, so you could continue to do another job, they would just give you a base salary. And we saw this referendum rejected soundly in Switzerland just this last Sunday. I want to talk about all the connections with that, as well as what is going on with the singularity, what is happening to people with globalism, and how it is the tool with which they are going to try to pacify us and turn us into what H.G. Wells called the Eloi. Remember that? At the very end of the book, they go forward into the future, and they see these little pink Jigglypuff things, and there's a cooing and all this kind of stuff. That's, in his mind, what humanity devolved into, but then there were these dark creatures that came up from underground. They were the Morlocks. And he realized that, first he thought, you know, the Eloi were in charge of everything. They were so, they were kind of taken care of and everything, but they he realized that they were simply the food source for the Morlocks. And so we're going to talk about the Precariat, who they're going to try to turn into Eloi. That's probably you, or will be you, pretty soon, because 95% of the people they're planning on in the next decade or so are going to lose their jobs to these disruptive technologies. Now, before we go back to the news, I just want to mention briefly that we do have Living Defense back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. This is something that we came out with a single run of it. It sold out incredibly quickly. It's very difficult to manufacture to the high standards that we manufacture. So it took us a while to do another batch. Alex did a triple batch, and now it's about to sell out, but it is still back in stock. It's going very quickly. You can find out about it at InfoWarsLife.com. 9 out of 10 people are infested with human organisms. Once these organisms have made it inside your body, they steal your nutrients, they release toxic wastes. You can eliminate the toxic and harmful organisms from your body using Living Defense. Read the reviews, read about it at InfoWarsLife.com. It is now back in stock, and not for long. Let's go back to Hillary Clinton. Of course, I have this article I just mentioned about how you know there's some emails that they do not want to have escape. They're blocking these. They're blocking FOIA requests for these emails that would show Hillary Clinton's deep support for the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which will destroy not only our economy, but our sovereignty. It'll destroy internet freedom. It'll destroy so many things. But we know that Obama is all in for this. And we know that one of the people that has been touted as a potential vice presidential candidate for Hillary Clinton, going back, the Castro brothers, we've talked about them from Texas, one of them a congressman, one of them the former mayor of San Antonio, both of them the spawn of one of the founders of the racist Hispanic organization, La Raza. Okay, that's what people need to understand with all this back and forth about Donald Trump. You want to talk about La Raza? What if I told you that I just joined a group for white males? I want to promote white males. I want to make sure there's more white males in higher positions. I want to give scholarships exclusively to white males. And the motto of this organization that I have joined for white males says everything for white males. If you're not a white male, you get nothing. What if I told you that was our motto for our organization? Would you say I was a white supremacist? Would you say I was a racist? You would be right if you did, okay? If I joined an organization like that. La Raza, the race, their motto is everything for the race, nothing for those outside of the race. So don't tell me that this judge who is handing out scholarships to people on the basis of them being Hispanic and illegal immigrants is not biased against Donald Trump, okay? But these two Castro twins, one of whom is a congressman, one of whom is now currently HUD secretary, used to be the mayor of San Antonio and wanted to try to get rid of the Alamo or completely reinvent it, he's been the congressman, Castro, has been touring Vietnam with Obama, talking about how they wanted to push TPP. And Obama was on Jimmy Fallon last night, joking about the TPP and talking about how we don't need somebody who's not a serious candidate. You know, Donald Trump really isn't a serious candidate. He does all this reality TV stuff, and you can't take the guy seriously. He's just an entertainer. And then Obama does this to prove his point.
That being said, the American people face an important decision this fall. The entire world is watching, and they look to us for stability and leadership. Now, I know some of the presidential candidates have been critical of my foreign policy. I don't want to name any names.
He's talking about Donald Trump.
But I believe it is of the utmost importance to work alongside other world leaders. That's why I signed the Iran nuclear deal. That's why we reopened diplomatic ties with Cuba. And that's why I negotiated the new trade deal called the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP.
Now hold on there, Fred Dispenser. Are you saying you're down with TPP?
Yeah, you know me.
Oh, isn't that great? TPP is now really cool. And it's really cool to go on and talk about how this other guy is just an entertainer. But I'm serious, right? Okay, seriously? Okay, now, besides the TPP, what else is Hillary unauthentic on? Of course, I want to play this for you. We mentioned it the other day. She came out in favor of building a wall. and deporting people who came here illegally from Mexico. She said Mexico was pushing people on us. Let's play this clip of Hillary Clinton 10 years ago.
Mexico is such an important problem. Mexican government's policies are pushing migration north. There isn't any sensible approach except to do what we need to do simultaneously, you know, secure our borders with technology, personnel, physical barriers if necessary in some places, and we need to have tougher employer sanctions, and we need to try to
incentivize barriers.
Mexico to do more. If they've committed transgressions of whatever kind, they should be
okay, physical barriers. We got to deport them. We got to have employer sanctions. And it's coming from the Mexican government who's pushing them on us. But she's not racist, is she? No, it's only racist when her opponent does it. And it's only a problem when their opponent does live television. But when they do it, they're serious. And they can make TPP sound cool because, you know, it rhymes with so many different things. Don't pay any attention to what's in it, okay? They kept it secret for years and years. Now, but we're told that Hillary Clinton is the first woman to run for president. And as somebody called up and pointed out to us, and said, no, we've had Green Party candidates who ran for it. We had Cynthia McKinney. We've also had Jill Stein. And there's been a whole slew, frankly, folks, of women who have run for presidency. Going back to 1872 was the first one. Victoria Woodhull. Women didn't even have the vote in 1872. But she ran for president back then. She was the first person to run for president. So they say, well, Hillary is the first major party candidate to run for president. Because, you know, the other parties don't count. Why don't they count? Well, that would be because of what the Democrats and Republicans have done to our democracy to make sure that they have a duopoly, that they have a monopoly, essentially, on power, because it truly is a single party. And so we can talk about who the first woman was or whatever. Does it really matter? Do you know who the first left-handed candidate we had for president was? Or the first redheaded candidate for president? Does it matter? You know, she likes to say, what difference does it make when you're talking about stranding people and leaving them to die at Benghazi? It doesn't make any difference. But it makes a difference when we talk about who the first woman president was. No, it doesn't. It doesn't make any more difference than the first left-handed person, quite frankly. What we need, and what I would like to celebrate, is maybe in my lifetime, the first candidate who takes individual liberty and the Constitution they swear to seriously. Now, that would be something to celebrate. I don't really care about your identity politics that you like to play here. And if you want to play that, you know, we can play the trivia game. We had a Libertarian Party candidate, Toni Nathan, was the VP. She was the first woman to get an electoral college vote. So what? Okay. Back in 1972, you had a guy who was supposed to go vote for Nixon, said, I just can't do it. And so he voted for the LP, and they got their first electoral college vote. But, you know, what's interesting about Woodhull is the fact that history doesn't repeat itself, but as we've said before, it certainly rhymes. And so I want you to take a look at some of the rhyming issues about Victoria Woodhull, the first woman who really did run for president, and how she lines up with Hillary Clinton, the first major party candidate to run for president. Okay, they're both feminists, both eugenicists, both support, and of course, Victoria Woodhull called it the free love idea. Okay, it's essentially an anti-family agenda. Let's destroy all the conventional norms about family and everything. She called it free love. That's Hillary Clinton with the LGBT movement. She was into occultic religion, spiritualist follower of an Austrian mystic, okay? Wouldn't be surprised about Hillary. I don't know if she has any religion other than politics. But one of the other things that Victoria Woodhull may have in common with Hillary Clinton is that when she was running for president, she was indicted. How about that? The first woman to run for president was indicted while she was running for president. Now, unlike Hillary Clinton, she was and her arch enemy at the time. And here's another place where history repeats itself. Okay, we have an evangelical big dog preacher. Okay, if you want to call him that, this is a guy who was a very well known abolitionist, and of course this is 1872. It was right after the Civil War, so he'd become very famous during the lead up to the Civil War. His name was Henry Ward Beecher, okay? He was a clergyman. And he was adamantly opposed to Victoria Woodhull and her free love, anti-family agenda. But he was also a prolific adulterer, a total hypocrite, which is another another thing that we continually see, another cookie-cutter stereotype. These stereotypes exist because they really are true, folks. So we've got this guy who's a famous clergyman who is this incredible hypocrite. And so they're having this very public argument going back and forth about free love. It's one of the things that she supports as being a feminist. Then she finds out, as one of the many women that he was having an affair with confessed to her husband, that information was taken from her husband to Victoria Woodhull, who also owned the press. And I guess you could kind of say Hillary Clinton doesn't actually own a newspaper, but in a sense, she does own the press, doesn't she? The Clinton News Network, they are very, very friendly to her. She doesn't actually hold stock in them. She doesn't actually do the hiring and firing, but she does own the press to a large degree. Well, Victoria Woodhull actually had a newspaper that she ran as a business. And so this woman who had an affair with this hypocritical clergyman who was at war with Victoria Woodhull confessed to her husband. He went to Victoria Woodhull, and she published details of the affair. They arrested Victoria Woodhull, took her to trial, indicted her, and charged her with sending obscenities through the mail because they said, well, you have published obscenities by talking about his affairs, and because you mailed your newspaper, we're going to get you for sending obscenity through the mail. I mean, you're talking about a stretch. That was a stretch. But anyway, she was eventually cleared. He was actually went on trial from being in a civil trial for charges of adultery. But the interesting thing about it, too, is that it completely took Reconstruction off of the headlines, just as we see today. They'll focus on the salacious details of celebrity sex. This is 1872. And completely miss one of the darkest chapters in our country's history, Reconstruction, which they didn't want to talk about anyway. Gave them a good excuse to get that off. So if you look at history, isn't it interesting how the stereotypes just continue to repeat themselves? Now, the other day I was talking about the precariat, one of the admitted topics by the Bilderbergers that I thought was kind of interesting. It was something that I didn't know about prior to that. I started doing research on it. And of course, a book that was written in 2014 really helped to accelerate this. And so there was a lot of people talking about it in 2015, and now it's become a big deal. The end game of this, which I really didn't get to the other day, was the idea they're going to provide a universal basic income. This is unconditional welfare, folks. This is what's being proposed. And what's truly shocking when you look at this is not just that the Bilderbergers would be looking at this as an instrument of control, as they see things like the pushback and the rise of all of these anti-immigration parties, the people seeing what's being done to their currency and saying, we don't like what is happening with this consolidated government. So you have the rise of all these individual parties that they like to characterize as ultra-right-wing parties. And, of course, Donald Trump would be in that category. So how do we control this, I say? Well, this universal basic income. What I found that was really surprising was the fact that this is being supported by so many in the business community. Forbes, the Wall Street Journal, the American Enterprise Institute, the conservative slash libertarian think tank that is funded by the Koch brothers. They're all pushing this socialist utopian idea of a universal basic income. Look at this story from Forbes. Universal basic income is not a crazy idea, they tell us. And again, it's unconditional monthly income. And we just had this last Sunday, the Swiss had a referendum. They said, we're going to give $31,000 to every adult in Switzerland without conditions. You can still have a job. You can do whatever you want to. That's just going to be a basic level of income. And if that was a 40-hour work week, that would work out to $16 an hour pay. So there's your $15 an hour pay that Bernie and Hillary are pushing, the socialists are pushing. But it's a little bit more than that. And you get that for doing nothing. It says the concept has been called utopian, irresponsible, socialist. Yeah, because it is. It is. It was rejected by 77% of the Swiss voters. But then he says, last weekend, the Wall Street Journal published an extensive essay by American Enterprise Institute scholar Charles Murray in favor of universal basic income for the U.S. Now, many of you may not remember who Charles Murray is. I remember him. I remember his book, Losing Ground, 1984. It was a big deal. It was the intellectual basis for massive welfare reform during the Reagan administration. And the fundamental premise of his book, Losing Ground, was to go back and look at people in the inner city, the poor in the inner city, predominantly black, and saying, look at how welfare has destroyed these communities. At one point in time, there were rising small businesses that were coming up. But then when welfare came in, it completely shut that down. And the longer it's been there, the more firmly it got entrenched, the more it's harmed those people. We saw the same thing in Indian reservations. It's by design. It's how they make you passive. It's how they control you. And they've got a dangerous class they call the precariat that they want to control. But what has flipped these people? Why have they gone from saying we can't have welfare that increases dependency to promoting the idea that we're going to have universal welfare without any strings? Stay tuned. I'll tell you what's up with that. We'll be right back. Real quickly, before we get back to what I was talking about with the universal basic income, the universal joining of the socialist left and Wall Street together. That's what they're talking about at Bilderberg. And I'm going to tell you how they are joined together at the hip. Before I do, real quickly, Living Defense is now back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. Our first batch sold out very quickly. Alex tripled the size of it, and it is quickly selling out again. Go to InfoWarsLife.com before we sell out. It's very important that you understand 9 out of 10 people are infested with harmful organisms. And you can pick these up in a variety of ways. Once these organisms have made it inside your body, they will steal your nutrients. They will release toxic waste. It's time to start eliminating these toxic, harmful organisms. Yeah, organizations. I'm talking about so many different organizations. But these are parasites inside your body, besides the guys at Bilderberg. Eliminate these from your body using Living Defense. And again, you can find out more about that at InfoWarsLife.com. It is selling out very quickly, even though we have tripled the batch run on this. Now, going back to what we were talking about, I've got, when I started talking about the precariat, I had somebody email me going back and said, well, you know, it didn't start back in 2014. That's Guy Standing's book, The Precariat, The Dangerous Social Class, and that's what they're talking about at Bilderberg now. I said it didn't start in 2014. They're going back 2011, 2012, even going back to 2010. I'm not really sure when this started, but it's going back farther and farther. But it is something that is being sold to us by the socialists, of course, okay? You look at this and you talk about precariat, when you break everybody down into these classes that need to be managed. That's the way the Marxists always look at people. You belong to a class, and how are we going to manage this class warfare that we've got going here? Well, the very idea, the very terminology of precariat harkens back to proletariat. They also talk about a solitariat. This would be the higher level minions who still have all the privileges and benefits like pensions and vacations and things like that. Okay. Then there's some other people who still get paid. They're the proficients. Those are people who are the technological people that are needed and highly skilled, but they're not going to have the kind of security that the solitariat has. Okay. The upper level minions. The proficients are going to have multiple jobs that they hold throughout their career. They're going to have to move around. And we've seen this developing for quite some time in the engineering community. You're not going to have, you don't go to work, and it's been this way for a long time. Even when I was beginning as an engineer, it was pretty well understood that you're not going to go get a job for IBM and stay there for 40 years and get some kind of a wonderful pension when you leave. No, you're going to keep moving from company to company. And if you got a pension, it's going to be because you saved the money yourself. So we've seen what happened with the proficients, but now what's happening, and it's going to happen in an accelerating way, are that the people that are at the lower level job skills, they're going to be making less money, they're going to be in a very precarious and dangerous position. No stability in their life. They're the ones who are totally getting screwed first, because it's going to get everybody, folks. But the first ones to feel the heel of globalism on their throat. And I'm looking at this lecture series that they sent me, The Future of the Left, that was done back in November 2012. Whatever happened to parliamentary socialism, socialist democracy, and so forth? Has the left a future, and so forth? They're talking about it from a leftist standpoint. But when we go back and we look at these business publications, as I was pointing out, we've got Forbes, Wall Street Journal, Business Insider. In the wake of this Swiss referendum, they're all talking about how wonderful and how necessary it is for us to have a universal basic income. This is being pushed by some of the most anti-welfare, historically anti-welfare people you had around. The American Enterprise Institute, David Koch, Charles Murray, and others. I'm going to follow up on this tonight on the InfoWars Nightly News. There's not enough time to finish it tonight. Join us tonight at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern for the Nightly News.